43 Americans forced to abandon cautiousness in the middle of the Florida coast. Marooned here since midweek, they must work together to build alliances, find fuel, and survive the racetrack.
Be wary of alliances. They may be the ones who bump you off.
But ultimately, it is everyone for himself. This evening, they will drive deep into the night to take part in a weekly ritual where, despite their closeness, they will do all they can to eliminate their competition one by one.
Take it from me. Try to lead, not follow.
In the end, only one driver will remain and will leave this fabled racing town with his first place share of a $3 million purse.
I know who I want to get rid of.
Drivers. 400 miles. Who will survive tonight?
America's biggest 4th of July tailgate party, the Pepsi 400. It's the nation's largest nighttime sporting event. It's old-fashioned Saturday night stock car racing before 165,000 folks wearing pride on a t-shirt for any one of 43 All-American risk takers, each committed to winning one of the biggest Winston Cup races this season. Among the principals for tonight's race, Bobby Labonte, the point leader. 27th and final performance for Darrell Waltrip here. 84 wins, but never this race. And Jeffrey Bodine, who went as close to the edge as one can and survived in February, is back and ready to start. Reigning Winston Cup point champion Dale Jarrett has won two consecutive races here at Daytona, aiming to tie Cale Yarborough's three consecutive wins here. He's on the pole for tonight's race. He's with Dick Berggren.
Thanks, Ken. It is said that the man who wins at Daytona is the man who can keep the throttle on the floor more than anybody else. Dale Jarrett, how much of tonight's race will you try to run wide open?
I hope that we can run the whole race wide open. Being out front, obviously, is the key to that. But you've got to have a good handling race car, and I hope that's exactly what we can do. That's what we've been able to do when we've won here in the past. And on behalf of all the drivers, we'd like to say thank you to CBS. We know this is your last Winston Cup race. And for everything that you've done for our sport, for each of the drivers here, thank you very much for bringing this great sport that we have to our great fans out there.
Thank you, DJ. Best wishes tonight. Terrell Shaheen.
34 times Dale Earnhardt has wheeled a car into victory lane here at the Daytona International Speedway utilizing different types of cars. Dale, what is the key to winning on this big racetrack?
Well, let's stay in time and stand out of trouble, making the right moves to be around at the end.
Dale Earnhardt will start 18th here tonight. Bill Stevens.
Three-time Winston Cup champion Jeff Gordon is looking for his third win in the Pepsi 400. If he gets it, he'll be the first driver to win three races this season. But Jeff, you're starting in the back of the bus. Can you get to the front and keep this car in one piece?
Well, this car did it for us in Talladega, but we're going to have our work cut out for us to do it here at Daytona. This is a little bit different deal. It's a lot narrower. Handling becomes a big issue here. And, you know, we got a long ways to go, but if anybody can do it, it's this DuPont team. And the guys have been awesome in the pits, and we're going to need them. We're going to need everything we can get to the front.
Kent Squire, it could be a wild night for the number 24.
43 drivers ready to fly like eagles, but right now is butterfly time. They're all cinched up and ready to go, just waiting to hit those switches and get this thing underway. Sun beginning to set over the 2.5 mile Daytona track, lit for only the third time, and we should see just one great race tonight. We're about to go down to the ceremonial grounds here at Daytona, where we will join them for the pre-race program that launches another event here at the birthplace of speed,
Daytona Beach, Florida. Let's join them now.
And now, as we are joined by a coast-to-coast live audience on CBS, our invocation by the Reverend Hal Marchman.
Let us pray. Almighty God and Father of all mankind, we thank you for this great nation in which we live, one nation under God, indivisible, and we pray that you will abide with all of the people who participate in this race. We thank you for these wonderful fans and for your love shed abroad in all of our hearts. Shalom and amen.
And now, to honor America on this 4th of July weekend, three-time Grammy Award winner, Trisha Yearwood.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hail at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still.
Timed flyover was by four F-16 Fighting Falcons from Shaw Air Force Base and the 20th Fighter Wing. The flight lead tonight is Lieutenant Colonel John Norman, number two, Captain Tom Seymour, number three, Colonel Mike Ely, and number four, Captain Darren Gray. Let's give them, along with Trisha Yearwood, a big hand for a great start tonight. And now for the most famous words in motorsports, the Grand Marshal of the 42nd Pepsi 400, Governor George W. Bush.
Gentlemen, start your engines.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Ken Squire here at the Daytona International Speedway, welcome you to CBS coverage of the 42nd annual $3 million Pepsi 400. We hope you're enjoying this holiday, and we know you're going to enjoy this always dramatic, always spectacular American Classic. 43 of the nation's finest drivers taking speeds of close to 200 miles an hour in what they consider a sprint event, 400 miles, just 160 laps. This becomes race number 17 of 34, halfway through the $95 million Winston Cup Tour. And a look at the Winston Cup standings is a who's who of U.S. motorsports. Bobby Labonte leads by 67 over Dale Earnhardt, seeking his eighth Winston Cup title. No one's ever done it. Back a little further in the point standings tonight, in 10th spot is Jeff Gordon, who will start 34th in this event. He is a three-time champion. Matt Kenseth, a rookie, is 13th in points with a win this year. And starting in 14th is Dale Earnhardt Jr., that other rookie who's won two events. That point fund alone is worth $10 million to the top 25 Winston Cup drivers. $3 million to the champion, $65,000 even back in the 25th position. So when you see them fall out and come back in here tonight, that's the reason why. Let's go topside to the folks who call the race tonight with Mike Joy, Ned Jarrett, and Buddy Baker.
Thanks, Ken, and hello, everyone. We're all kind of on pins and needles with great anticipation for this event, because only at NASCAR's two fastest tracks, Daytona and Talladega, do you have this tight pack racing. The field is all packed together, not for safety from predators, because those predators come from within. And Buddy Baker, 1983 winner of this race, when you're back in that pack, how do you get a fast car to the front?
Well, you look in your mirror first, you have a bunch of cars with you. You go three wide down the back straightaway. You're trying to figure where to go. You know, if you make it four wide, you're not going through the corner. All of a sudden, somebody starts to move. You go with him. The cars with you go. It makes a very aerodynamic package. You push that car by. All of a sudden, you have a friend.
For how long?
Until you find somebody a little faster, and it's all off.
Ned Jarrett, two-time champion. NASCAR has mandated engine restrictions at these two fastest tracks to slow the cars. A driver doesn't have the power to pull out and pass. So why are the drivers calling this a chess game?
Well, because you have to plan your moves, Mike. You got to plan your next move before you make the move that you're about to make out there on the racetrack. And as Buddy said, drafting is so important on this racetrack, and you got to size up the competition almost in every corner and make moves all over the racetrack. And in that two and three wide racing, sometimes you do it right and sometimes you make a mistake. And pit stops are awfully important too. Now, if this race should go green from start to finish, they can make it on just two pit stops. But it takes some good planning to do that, and certainly some good work in the pits to get them back out on time.
43 cars are on track on the first of the preliminary laps as we're set to go racing under the lights at Daytona in the Pepsi 400. We'll be back with the starting lineup and the start of the race next.
CBS Sports presentation of the Pepsi 400 is sponsored by Pepsi, the joy of cola. The new 2000 Ford Taurus with the advanced personal safety system. And by Route 66, jeans, clothes. It's not Main Street, only at Kmart.
Officially, we're 10 minutes from a beautiful Florida sunset on a day that started out hazy and very, very muggy. The 90-degree temperatures have now descended, as has the humidity, which began this morning, noontime, 90%, 81 degrees, 56% humidity, wind from the northeast at 12. Nice night to go racing here in Central Florida. Let's have a look at the starting lineup for the 42nd Pepsi 400. 10th career pole for Dale Jarrett and 5th front row start for his teammate Ricky Rudd. They're both in Fords. Bill Elliott, the 88 and 91 winner of this race, and rookie Dave Blaney with his best career start. Martinsville winner Mark Martin and Ward Burton, who won at Darlington. Tony Stewart, two-time winner, and Jerry Nadeau in the top 10 for the sixth time this year. Daytona 500 runner-up Jeff Burton, and Elliott Sadler was his third top 10 start of the year. Ed Barrier, rookie and ageless Junie Donlevy's car, great qualifying run for him. And Rusty Wallace looking for his first restrictor plate win. Rookie Stacy Compton back in the seventh row there with Kenny Schrader. Good qualifying efforts for both. Mike Skinner, top five finishes in his last two Pepsi 400s. And Kyle Petty's 580th career start. Jimmy Spencer, the 94 winner. And Dale Earnhardt, a two-time champion of this race. Chad Little, sixth at Atlanta. And Johnny Benson, nearly the Cinderella winner of the Daytona 500 this year. There's the point leader, Bobby Labonte, looking for his first win since Rockingham. And Matt Kenseth, the rookie who won at Charlotte. Robert Presley and rookie Mike Bliss in the 12th row. Rick Mast and second row day fastest qualifier Kenny Wallace. Steve Park and Kenny Irwin in Chevrolets. John Andretti, the 97 winner, and Kevin LePage. Dale Earnhardt Jr., that rookie, has two wins with Ricky Craven. Darrell Waltrip's 55th Daytona Winston Cup start in his final one. Jeff Gordon, 34th, but he won at Talladega from 36th, don't forget. Wally Dallenbach and Scott Pruitt in row 18. Then the provisional starters, Terry Labonte and Jeremy Mayfield. Sterling Marlin, the 96 winner, and Joe Nemechek. Michael Waltrip and Bobby Hamilton, with Jeffrey Bodine taking the final position.
There were three drivers who failed to qualify for this event: Brett Bodine, Robbie Gordon, and Dave Marcus.
Manufacturer's breakdown in tonight's race. There'll be 18 Ford, 15 Chevrolets, and 10 Pontiacs. Ford leads them all with 7 wins this year.
There are 43 cars starting this race. They go 160 laps, that's 400 miles. They're racing for a purse of almost $3 million. The fuel window is 50 to 60 laps. And the race record was set back in 1980 by Bobby Allison at a little over 173 miles an hour.
Fritos takes us inside racing as Buddy takes us for a nighttime lap around Daytona.
And a quick one it is, leaving pit road. You could go out. This is a little short shoot here, down into turn one, 31 degrees here. Preferred line right around the bottom. As the tires give up, you use more racetrack. Down the long back straightaway into turn three, 31 degrees also. Coming off turn four, there's a bump there. A lot of drivers have problems. Now through the tri-oval, that's a great place to pass.
Field on the backstretch, a lot of flashes there in the backstretch, watching Dale Jarrett as his CBS race cam, the Ford Credit Quality Service cam, on the pole. And right alongside is Robert Yates' Ford teammate, the Texaco Haviland cam on Ricky Rudd's Ford. Back to the fourth row, Tony Stewart, the Home Depot cam on his Joe Gibbs Pontiac. And in the fifth row, right behind him, Jeff Burton, the XI Batteries camera in that Roush Racing Ford. In row eight, Mike Skinner, the Lowe's Home Improvement cam in his Richard Childress Racing Chevy. And then to the point leader, Bobby Labonte, new paint job, and the Circuit City cam on board his Joe Gibbs Pontiac. Rick Mast, the Conseco camera in the A.J. Foyt Pontiac, back in the 13th row. Dale Earnhardt Jr., two-time winner, the Bud cam on board his Earnhardt Chevrolet. And Jeff Gordon starting 34th in the Hendrick Motorsports Chevrolet, carrying our final CBS race cam as we get set to go at Daytona for 400 miles under the lights. Dick Berggren.
This is a restrictor plate. Every single one of the race cars on the speedway right now has one of these between the carburetor and intake manifold. 4 7/8-inch holes in that restrictor plate control the amount of air going into the engine. Cut it about in half. Without those four holes, that is what we would see. We'd have twice as much horsepower, much more speed.
Still, we'll see 190 miles an hour. Hallie Eisenberg waves the green flag, and we're racing.
One thing that Dale Jarrett and Ricky Rudd protected themselves against, a lot of times when the front row goes into turn one side by side, that third place man can drop past them as they come off of turn two, but they quickly got in line first and second before they got to that turn to prevent that.
But back in the war zone here, you can see three wide down the back straightaway. They're now getting up to speed. They're only running about 185 miles an hour. The next time they go down through there, they'll be at full song.
Three fast Fords front this field. Jarrett, Rudd, Elliott.
Mark Martin's moved into fourth place.
And it's double wide from there on back. A clean first lap. First non-Ford is Tony Stewart's Pontiac in fifth. Starting 34th. It's the ninth race of the season that Jarrett has led.
Jeff Gordon on the move now down the back straightaway. He's following Kenny Irwin Jr. right there in the 42. He's looking to the middle part there. Dale Earnhardt just to the left in front. Justin on the right side there, and John Deere Ford is Chad Little.
There they go, three wide. Well, that was a pretty gutsy move by Irwin to move up on that inside or right in the middle of those cars.
Well, Jeremy Mayfield almost makes contact there.
That was contact. Look at how much watch those cars dance around. You think they're stable? Think not. Look at this.
Jeff Burton down on the inside, made it three wide on the inside of Tony Stewart. Bill Elliott up on the outside.
Jerry Nadeau in the 25 there in the middle there just for a second. See, the number two there, that's a different paint job. You'll have to get used to looking at Rusty Wallace. Solid blue car with flames down the side. He's been very quick in practice here all week.
Patience? Heck, I want to pass something.
Oh, yeah, you're getting that draft, and it just feels like you picked up 100 horsepower and said, man, I can go. But you get up there, and sometimes you can't.
Two laps ago, Bill Elliott was third. Last lap, he was fifth because he's on the outside lane. Now, six cars have drafted by him on the inside.
He's trying to get down there, even hoping somebody will come up there on that outside that will help to give him a little bit of a push. But so far, the inside lane is the fastest.
There's Elliott, top groove, leading that second lane.
Boy, and Jeff Gordon is absolutely flying around the top part of the racetrack as we watch the groups. Now they're making two lines, and when they get this filed out, the outside line can run just as fast as the lower lane.
The 12 of Jeremy Mayfield from 38th to 19th place in only three laps. Wow.
Tell me you can't pass in restricted plate racing.
There's Sterling Marlin in the 40 right in the middle part of the racetrack, now on the bottom lane there. He's moving up quite a bit right now also.
Bottom of the screen, there's Mayfield right off the bottom. Gaining positions as quickly as Gordon.
Gordon on the outside there looking at the Mike Bliss car, taking the high line around the racetrack. He has Kenny Wallace just behind him in the 55, but look at Sterling Marlin come up through the middle there. He is flying up through there.
And Jeff Gordon really in that 24 car is riding that high rim, buddy.
That's hold your breath racing. Look at Mayfield down on the inside of the racetrack.
I was just fixing to say, don't do that. That's Johnny Benson in the number 10 car there. No sponsorship on that car in this race.
Now the low line so far is the fast way around. Why?
While the tires are cool and before they get heated up too much, it's the shortest way around for one reason, but also those tires get heated up.
I'm sorry, I got excited. Tony Stewart was on the flat part of the racetrack through the tri-oval here. I thought he had just made a rookie mistake, but it got him second spot.
You think you're excited? How about Ricky Rudd, who was alongside him when that happened?
And Bill Elliott just came right along with him. You see Ricky Rudd dropping back now. He's decided maybe I don't want to bump fenders right at the moment.
Well, he got up there in that outside lane and couldn't go.
I think he lost his momentum when Stewart got down the inside and bounced up off the flat.
What he did was what a lot of drivers that have experience do here. He gave that kid a break and let him get back up on the racetrack because that could have been a big wreck.
Six laps complete this time by, and we're still holding our breath. Upper left of your screen, those boxes in green are drivers that gained a position the last lap. A driver in red lost a position the last lap. Still three wide in the middle of the pack. Good advice.
Spotters doing a lot of talking.
Dale Earnhardt Jr. way up high. That's in Barrier.
Now, he rolled out the throttle there. Had he not done that, Barrier would have come across. That would have been a big wreck. He's learning every race he runs now not to stick his nose into problems like that.
The front eight cars have pulled off single file, and this is the battle behind them. They're still two and three wide right in the center of that pack. Oh, off turn four.
Don't make me wrong. There he goes, right up through the middle, riding with Dale Earnhardt Jr. 190 miles an hour, side by side, going right down the middle of the racetrack and picking up a lot of positions.
Now, oftentimes, the driver in the middle would get squeezed like a hot dog out of the bun and squeezed back. Not tonight.
Well, what he has is Dave Blaney there in the 93. He's drafting up on him now. He'll look like... Oh, boy, they're bump drafting down through there. What you try to do is get real close and actually touch the car in front of you. If you can get close enough, it'll pick both cars up about 200 RPMs.
Well, we noticed that Jeff Gordon there in that last picture, he had moved down to the inside. He'd been riding that highway, but evidently he heard us say, no, he didn't, that the inside line was the fastest, but he figured that out on his own.
Well, back there, I don't think you have much choice. They're three wide. Look at this. Look at this, Mike. They're three by three down through the trials.
Now, look, here's Elliott Sadler all by himself in the middle, and he is getting squeezed back in that number 21.
Well, that's did. He's moving back in his spot. Okay, and take, okay, you got an opening here. If you can get there. There you got up there behind the 18 car, Bobby Labonte.
Chess at 190 miles an hour.
Jerry Nadeau leading this group, the 25 car, but look at the first five or six cars here. They've actually broken away. That's what you call aerodynamic. Everybody riding nose to tail. They run much quicker in cars running side by side. They cut a smaller hole through the air, and it also streamlines that group.
Eight cars in that lead draft that are pulling away.
From our Survivor theme, that front pack is Fantasy Island. Here's Gilligan's Island. And from the blimp, here's a look at the breakaway of the lead pack, which was eight cars, single file, and look at this snarling pack behind them. .3 seconds. First back to eighth.
Ricky Rudd is about to fall off the draft of that lead group. I'm a little surprised. There he is back there, but you see how far he is back there. So he's losing a little bit of ground to the lead.
Well, oh, one car bounce. I believe he did touch the wall toward the back of that pack. Bobby Hamilton looked for a little scrape on the right rear corner. He got it straightened out right away, but that was close.
Now, talking about what Ned was just referring to, the four car does not have seem to have any damage to the right side. I don't see any smoke trailing it. So if he did hit it, it just maybe flatten the side a little bit.
Tense moment for Hamilton. He's toward the back of that second pack. Steve Park trying to pull Scott Pruitt and Kevin LePage along. There's Ricky Craven and Kyle Petty in the 44. Inside the 17 of Matt Kenseth. Now Kenseth qualified 22nd, but crashed in practice and had to start at this backup car at the tail end of the field.
They're running laps faster than Dale Jarrett qualified for the pole.
And I'm noticing some of the cars are not able to keep up with that front draft right now. Ward Burton's starting to fall off the group. The 28 car there of Ricky Rudd's dropping back a little bit, but back here the war continues.
Pit Road, Ralph Shaheen.
Mike, one of those cars that is slipping back is the 28 of Ricky Rudd. Started on the outside of the front row, back to eighth. I just talked to his crew chief, Michael McSwain. I said, Michael, what's wrong with the car? He says, nothing but horsepower. Rudd's got his foot to the floor, and he just can't hang on to the draft. I can't build any more horsepower now. Dick Bergeron.
Well, everything's going well for Dale Jarrett. You know, he won the Daytona 500, won the pole for that race, led the most laps. This is not the same car. Daytona impounds the car that wins the Daytona 500 every year, puts it in Daytona, USA. A museum, so they had to build this car. They built it as close to that winning car as they possibly could, brought it to the wind tunnel to test it, brought it to the racetrack to test it in an extraordinary effort. It is paying off tonight. To Bill.
Well, Dick Berger and Bill Elliott is driving the car that he did not race at Daytona, but not because that one's in a museum. It's now the backup car. This car is a new one. And right now, Bill says he can drive it just about any place on the racetrack and keep pace. By the way, the car he drove in Daytona was Mac Daddy. This one they call Mac Mama.
Okay. Ford Pontiac Ford, as Dale Jarrett leads Tony Stewart and Bill Elliott. Fords of Jeff Burton and Rusty Wallace, fourth and fifth. We complete 13 laps at Daytona in the Pepsi 400. Bobby Hamilton has made a pit stop in the Morgan McClure Chevrolet. Dale Jarrett's Ford continues to lead Tony Stewart's Pontiac, Bill Elliott's Ford, Jeff Burton and Rusty Wallace. It's now a five-car pack as you see them. Mark Martin has lost touch with that lead draft and drifted back, picking up Ward Burton's Pontiac and that black and orange Ford of Ricky Rudd. They have about a second and a half on the pack behind them.
Now, what might happen here if these three cars really hook up and run real close to each other? With the draft off the cars that are in front of them, that you really can't see at this moment, they can really run them back down again, but they can't race each other. They'll have to stay in line like that.
Likewise, those front five want to stay single file to get away.
They want to get as far away from the pack as they possibly can, because if this thing goes green until that first pit stop, that'll give them a big advantage.
42 of the 43 starters still locked in that draft. Bobby Hamilton has made a pit stop.
And he went a lap down. He's out on the racetrack running by himself, so he's going to have to pedal hard, or he could go two laps down.
Dale Earnhardt Jr. has been fearless. Started 31st. He is up to 17th, making a lot of moves in that pack. Let's ride with him.
That's John Andretti, that new paint job on Pettycar there, the 43. You see right now, they're actually fanning out. The cars are beginning to give up a little traction in the racetrack. And you see them sliding around. Bobby Labonte there on the inside. And Stacy Compton in the 9 car there, just in front of Earnhardt Jr. as they come down the front straightaway.
New paint job for Labonte on that back bumper. Those aren't scratches. Those are baseball stitches. It's a baseball-themed paint job on his Pontiac. Still 2x2.
They're trying their best to break loose and get single file, but they just simply haven't been able to do it.
Looking back from our Circuit City cam on board Bobby Labonte, that's Stacy Compton. Next year, he'll drive a Dodge, number 92 for Mark Melling's team.
I'm sure that once Bobby got in front of him, up the line, he said, come on, man, come on, get up on my back bumper, and let's see if we can't pull away from this crowd.
A pack of five, a pack of three, a group of four, a twosome, table for one.
And they're beginning to single out back through the pack as the tires get heated up.
There's the second group at the bottom of your screen. Mark Martin with Ward Burton and Ricky Rudd. Then here is the group of four, Schrader, Earnhardt, Nadeau, and Mike Skinner.
And they're making great time right now. I think they're running laps just as fast as the leaders. Everybody's pretty much stabilized in groups right now. And it'll take these guys, a minute somebody flares out and starts racing, they'll either gain or lose in a hurry.
Pretty much single file down through the top 25 or so. Front, it's a Ford in front, a Pontiac, and then four Fords. Do the Fords have had an advantage in qualifying? Eight of the top dozen. Do they have an advantage in the race?
It's all for early to really make a decision on that. What we have right now is cars that are really fast, and they proved it in qualifying. They haven't got to the point where they burned off a lot of fuel and all started wearing the tires out, where the cars lose grip in the corner.
After about 30 or 40 laps is when you'll tell how the handling is on the race cars.
A 22-gallon tank full of that $4.50 a gallon gasoline. You thought your pump price was high? Try this 110 octane, the 76 stuff. That'll last you about 50 to 60 laps here.
And that's a lot more than they normally get on unrestricted tracks. The restrictions that they put on, that Dick Bergman showed you, that plate that goes on the carburetor doesn't pull near as much fuel through there, and as a result, it doesn't burn as much. They can go 125 to 140 miles on a tank of fuel. On an unrestricted track, you're talking 100 or less.
Now, about four laps ago, Mark Martin drifted from the lead group back to head that second pack. Let's go to his pit, Dick Bergman.
I just talked to crew chief Jimmy Finnegan, asked him what was going on. He said, nothing, we just can't keep up. But then we heard Mark on the radio and the adjustments he has called for if they next pit, suggested his car is running a little loose, tail ends trying to come out. The 22 of Ward Burton, on the other hand, has exactly the opposite problem. Nose is pushing out toward the wall. He wants to adjust it on the next pit stop.
And you could see that in the shots just before that. Ward Burton was moving up the racetrack. Mark was hugging the bottom part of the racetrack. And to really catch that front group, what they're doing, they're catching them very slowly. They're reeling them in, though.
They are moving in closer every lap.
The first side-by-side battle on the racetrack is back at 18th. Elliott Sadler taking a position from Jeremy Mayfield. He and Kenny Wallace working together. Terry Labonte on the move on the high side.
Michael Walker down the inside. Here's the Elliott Sadler car, the number 21, down at the bottom of the racetrack.
Jeremy Mayfield's going to get that position back.
Yeah, Jeremy got very, very loose a while ago coming off turn two. I watched him. He was looking in the infield. It was that far sideways. Great piece of driving to get that car back straight. But Jeremy did get, he lost about five or six positions getting it back straight.
190 miles an hour, flat out, foot on the floor, all the way around, 22 laps, break that 23 laps. Now complete, here's Ken Squire.
If you're one who plays the numbers, consider this. This race in 41 previous runnings has only been won four times from the pole. The hot number to start in would be position number three, where Bill Elliott started. Six times they've had a winner from there. That's the most.
Elliott runs in third behind Jarrett's Ford and Stewart's Pontiac. We're early in the game. 23 of 100 60 laps complete. CBS Sports coverage of the Pepsi 400 continues after this message and a word from your local station. Asked you who would take the checkered flag tonight. The votes are in. You folks thought Dale Earnhardt's going to win tonight's Pepsi 400. For complete poll results, click on Auto Racing at cbs.sportsline.com or on AOL, hit keyword CBS Sportsline. Well, your pick in the poll, Dale Earnhardt, currently runs in ninth position. At 27 laps, we're caution-free, no pit stop, save for Bobby Hamilton. Dale Jarrett's fourth from the pole. Continues to lead Tony Stewart's Pontiac, Bill Elliott's Ford, Jeff Burton's Ford, and the Ford of Rusty Wallace. A little further back, Mark Martin, Ward Burton, Ricky Rudd, Dale Earnhardt, Bobby Labonte.
Look at Bill Elliott rim riding up way up on the top part of the racetrack. There's one or two things to make him do that. Maybe running real close in the draft there down the straightaways is running the temperature up, because they do block up the nose with a lot of tape there to make him more aerodynamic and have more downforce. He may be getting air in, and he pulls right back down and drafts with him as they go through the straightaways.
And looks like he's trying to move on the inside of Tony Stewart, but he doesn't have any drafting help. But he might have done it to get a good run too, buddy. And now they broke away a little bit from Jeff Burton. And we mentioned before we went to commercial that Mark Martin and his group were gaining on this front group. Well, they've stopped gaining and started losing since then.
They may gain a little here because Stewart is getting a little racy on race leader Dale Jarrett. Now, a couple of laps ago, Stewart backed up about six car lengths from Jarrett. Jarrett eased into turn three to keep the two of them close. Last time going into one, the fastest part of the racetrack, Stewart had a look to the inside, but Dale Jarrett's number 88 had the low lane covered.
I think Bill right now is trying to find a place that his car is pretty happy at. This end of the racetrack, he runs right on the yellow line, right on the bottom. The other down in turns one and two, he's looking for a place that he likes to run the car because it's not real comfortable down low.
Let's go back to ninth place. There is Dale Earnhardt leading the Winston Cup point leader, Bobby Labonte. The two of them are locked in this fight for the championship. Two of many, but they're at the top of the heap. Ralph?
Mike, he's running with Bobby Labonte right behind him and Johnny Benson in the white number 10. Now, what these three drivers are doing is playing a little bit of leapfrog as we go on board with Bobby Labonte right now. Bobby was leading it early on in this group. They found out that Dale was a little bit quicker in front, so Dale moved to the front. He's trying to pull the crew through now. Whichever one of these three cars is the fastest at the front, that's what they're going to keep doing. They're going to time each other, find out which car's in the front, and with the spotters are going to work together to find out which group is quickest. Dick Berger.
Well, Jeff Gordon is definitely having his problems tonight. Right now, he is running in 27th spot. He had moved up further, but he's dropped back, and the crew says it is just the draft. He has had a tough time here at Daytona, finishing 38th in the 500, 21st in this race last year. They are struggling right now. To Bill.
Ned, you mentioned earlier it would take some laps for these guys to figure out just how good their cars would handle. Well, Bill Elliott started with a great car. It's now become a good car. He says it's tight coming off of the turns, and they'll have to make some adjustments when he comes in for his first pit stop.
But that's why he's running probably in that high groove, is because if the car is tight, he can run up there and free it up just a little bit.
You're exactly right.
Jarrett the leader, 88. The Robert Yates Ford, the Joe Gibbs Pontiac, number 20. The orange and white car is Tony Stewart. And in black, yellow, and red, Bill Elliott's Ford. Next year, Elliott goes to Dodge with Ray Evernham. So this is his final Daytona try to win in his own team.
And I'm sure he would like to pull that off tonight, and he's in good position to do it. Now that group in front has become a foursome, as Rusty Wallace has lost that draft up front, and he is backed up now to Mark Martin and the group that is running back there.
Well, up front, Ned, they're averaging for this race 186.3 miles per hour. They're not waiting around.
Yeah, and one thing you have to remember, now everybody's saying all the Fords are just dominating, but the second place car right now is Pontiac. So it has a lot to do with the balance of the race car and the way they handle in the draft. Apparently right now, Rusty Wallace's car won't turn like he wants it to, and he's dropping back.
So you see your front four. Here are the two behind them, Rusty Wallace and Mark Martin. The two behind them on the right of your screen are Ward Burton and Ricky Rudd. Then comes a threesome led by Dale Earnhardt, including Bobby Labonte and Johnny Benson. Then on the right, Jerry Nadeau ahead of Mike Skinner. That takes you back through 13th position.
There you see Elliott running the high line once again as we go back toward Dale Earnhardt Jr. pulling a pack of cars along. Still some side-by-side racing back in the pack.
Junior's in 14th, Ned, in that number 8. Kenny Wallace with him. Jimmy Spencer, 26. Jeremy Mayfield, the 12. Elliott Sadler, the 21, in a paint job reminiscent of when Tiny Lund drove here for the Wood Brothers in 1963.
And won the Daytona 500.
Ralph Sheen.
Well, Mike, when you're racing together out on the racetrack, that means you also have to work together in the pits here at Daytona. So we have crew members from Joe Gibbs' number 18 team, Abadi Labonte, down here to Dale Earnhardt's pit, talking things over with crew chief Kevin Hamlin for Dale Earnhardt, trying to figure out when both of these teams are going to need to and want to pit. Because when you come down pit road, you need somebody to go with you back out on the racetrack to help pick up that draft again so you can quickly get back up to speed.
Ideally, the cars would want to pit under a caution flag when the field is corralled by the pace car, and they could do so at relative leisure. But if they have to pit under the green flag, as Ralph says, they'll have to make deals to come out together and have someone to draft with after the pit stop. Dick Berggren?
Dale Jarrett is trying to persuade the cars behind him to fall in line. He wants them to run exactly nose to tail. Tony Stewart said no problem. He can do that. On the other hand, Bill Elliott is having a bit of a problem with his engine temperature. Said he can't exactly fall in line. He has to pull out a little bit. Meanwhile, the 28 of Ricky Rudd, he has got a horrible push in that thing. Said every lap he's about to knock the wall down. Needs a pit stop badly.
And the back of the pack has gone pack racing again. Jeff Gordon is caught in the thick of it. A whole lot of double wide racing. About the 20th spot on back, and there they are. Gordon is 20th. Right in the midst of all that, there he drops to the inside on the left of your screen, number 24.
Boy, and Kenny Irvin Jr. in the 42 just cut him right off getting in the corner there. And what happened there is he had to roll out the throttle. Now he picks momentum up coming down the straightaway. You see, he has a little bit faster car, but he had to break his momentum just a little bit.
These guys getting racy back here in the pack. We see Jeremy Mayfield. He's the outside of Jeff Gordon right there in the 12 car. We mentioned early in the race that he'd gained a lot of position just in the last three or four laps. Mike, he got up there to a certain point, and apparently the tires got heated up and the handle went away on the car. So he's been pretty stable back there since then.
Yeah, he's drifted back to 21st position, Ned. And of course, 21st could be 28th or 19th one lap from now.
Yeah.
In that pack. That's the pack racing we spoke of at the top of the show. Side by side, two and three wide. And they'll continue to go at it like this. We've completed 36 laps, closing in on 100 miles here at Daytona. Miles and Dale Jarrett, your pole sitter and race leader, has just set a Pepsi 400 record. In 1964, Richard Petty led the first 39 laps of this race. Nobody had ever led the first 40. Jarrett's done that. Tony Stewart behind him in a Pontiac, Bill Elliott's Ford. There's your three-car lead trio. And behind them, Jeff Burton, Rusty Wallace, Mark Martin in Ford, Ward Burton's Pontiac, Ricky Rudd's Ford, Bobby Labonte's Pontiac, and the first Chevrolet is Dale Earnhardt in 10.
Still some good racing going on back in the pack. 75 car is Wally Dallenbach. There's Robert Preston, car number 77, down on the inside.
Just on the outside there in the 5 car, Terry Labonte.
And Labonte has come up from 37th starting position. A 12-spot gain. And those positions back in that pack are hard won.
They are hard to come by, that's for sure.
We are about 15 laps away from pit stop should this race continue under the green flag.
Yeah, and one thing that'll happen when they make these pit stops and adjust on these cars that are back in here now, if they have great pit stops and get in that lead draft and they make the right changes on them, they could have the car to beat after they make the first pit stop.
Frito's onboard telemetry with Robert Presley. Up into turn three. See the RPMs drop off just a little bit. His foot stays flat on the floor all the way around.
Yeah, he's on the high side of the racetrack, and Sterling Marlin just on the inside. Let's see what he runs down the front straightaway here. I see 188, and you notice the RPM way down. That's because they restrict the air and fuel through the carburetor, so there's no point in turning RPM because it don't make any more horsepower if you do turn it up.
It would be like you trying to breathe through a straw. That's what the engine's having to deal with those restrictors. They are NASCAR mandated to limit the speed on their two fastest tracks, Daytona and Talladega. Average speed at 100 miles, 186.3. That's the average for 100 miles. That speed would have been good for fifth spot on the grid in qualifying.
Here are the leaders. That foursome still there. Jeff Burton has dropped back a few times, but he's always been able to catch back up.
Just like Bill Elliott, he goes way up the racetrack in the corners, loses four or five car lengths, and then down the straightaway, runs them right back down.
He's running the high line coming off of turn two in particular, and that really gives him a run down the backstretch.
Larry McReynolds on the left, the crew chief for Mike Skinner, with his car owner Richard Childress and a representative of the Bobby Labonte team. Kevin Hamlin, Earnhardt's crew chief, on the right. What was that conversation about?
Well, what they want to do is, if they do a green flag stop, they want to come in with somebody they can draft with, and it's so important. It's like a half a second around the racetrack if you have help.
And Labonte was running ninth, Earnhardt 10th, and Skinner 12th. That's why they were all together. Ralph?
Well, Mike, the gentleman who's from Bobby Labonte's crew, too, is Mark Cronquist. He is the head engine builder for the 18 car, so nobody is going to know the fuel mileage of that car better than the guy that put the engine together. So that's why he's down here talking to the two crew chiefs and the car owner for the Richard Childress Racing Organization. They're trying to figure out when they think they're going to come in, possibly around lap 59. Those three cars will come in together.
Good point. Now, right behind Bobby Labonte, who you ride with, is Earnhardt. Behind him is the white car of Johnny Benson. Remember, Benson leading with about a half a dozen laps to go in the Daytona 500, and those three fast Fords gained up on him and stole the show. Benson found a sponsor, but this week those sponsor decals came off. Team representatives refused to comment, honoring their contract terms. Usually that happens when the checks don't come. So they are sponsor hunting to finish out the rest of the season for Tim Beverly's team.
They've had some great runs this year. In Bristol, they ran very, very well there. Here, everybody thought he had to race one, and the caution came out and let the Fords catch up. And on the restart, Dale Jarrett got under him and went on and won the race. But at one time, Johnny Benson looked like he may win the Daytona 500.
Had a great race car. And you see that number four car, Bobby Hamilton, up there. We mentioned that he made a green flag pit stop, went a lap down when he made that pit stop. Since then, he was out there running by himself, no one drafting with him until the leaders caught him. Now he has gone two laps down and still losing ground.
45 complete. We're about 10 laps from green flag pit stops, and from 190 left to come down pit lane at 55 miles an hour for fuel and tires.
Boy, I practiced that, and I will tell you, it is miserable to run that fast and then condition yourself to go down pit road at a certain RPM. You feel like you're absolutely stopped.
They have some onboard aids to help them with that pit road speed, but yep, that's tough. And then it's up to the service of those crews to put four tires and fuel in about 16 seconds and get you back underway. The lead pack. Now, Elliott has not been strong in the corners. He's climbed the hill, lost some distance to the front two, but on the straightaways, he has been strong and pulled right back to them.
Mike, you're exactly right. There's a lot of ponies in that 94 there. When he really gets after it down the straightaway, I think he's as fast or maybe a little faster than Dale Jarrett leading the race there, but in the corners, Dale Jarrett definitely has a better car.
Dale Jarrett has rewritten the record book for the Pepsi 400. He's been out front for every one of the 47 laps. You see how close they are. That doesn't mean he's stinking up the show. There's the Pontiac of Tony Stewart right with him. Bill Elliott's Ford, Jeff Burton's Ford. And it's not all that far back, about 3.5 seconds to Rusty Wallace and Mark Martin.
Now, Mike, about 20 laps ago, as we see those speeds up there, that 181, 182, and 183 miles an hour, I mentioned earlier that they were running laps faster than Dale Jarrett had qualified. Well, as the tires have heated up, they're slowing down. The speeds have fallen off considerably. Even for the front runners, they're still up there running about 185 to 186 miles an hour.
Stewart looking for his third win of the season. Jarrett, who won the Daytona 500, looking for his second. And Bill Elliott looking for his first victory since Darlington in 1994. Rick Mast with our Arrancha.com telemetry as you watch from the Conseco onboard camera atop his AJ Foyle Pontiac.
About 200 miles an hour. Still less than 7,000 RPMs.
And getting a tow from the car in front. It's Mike Bliss just ahead in another Pontiac.
Kenny Irvin Jr. takes off up the wall there. Just about, that was what you call an arrow push. That's where he had the wheels turned to the left. The car took off to the right.
You got a feel for Kenny Irvin. I don't think he's run two laps single file all night.
I just noticed something. He's picked up a little piece of plastic right there in the middle part of the grill there. And with that small opening, that could be a problem if it runs the car a little too hot, because you need a certain amount of air. And they really measured this off to get the proper amount of air with the proper downforce. Once a piece of plastic like that gets caught up on that nose, it could run that car a little bit warm.
Looking ahead at Jarrett from the Home Depot cam on Tony Stewart's Pontiac. Now, in addition to that, how will that change the airflow over the car and affect its handling?
Could have some effect there as well.
The one thing he has in his favor right now, nobody's in front of him, so he's getting a maximum air right now. But that is, you see, about half of that opening right there is plastic over it.
Now Jeff Burton beginning to fall back just a little bit from that lead trio.
All right, we're going to be back in about four or five laps for the first pit stops of the night. We've gone 50 laps, 125 miles, caution-free at Daytona.
After 51 laps complete, 127 and a half of 400 miles, just one leader. Setting all kinds of records here, Dale Jarrett, an average speed of 186 miles per hour. The record for 400 miles, Bobby Allison, 1980 at 173 miles per hour. One car in just a little bit of trouble. That was the Hamilton car, and caution is now on the track for debris as we get to lap number 54. Back to Mike Joy.
Thanks, Ken. The safety crews have their lights on over in turn number two. Apparently something off one of the cars as we watch from high above. These pictures from the Goodyear blimp, Stars and Stripes. A 75-year tradition continues as Goodyear's fleet of three domestic and four international blimps provide service at major sporting events, the aerial ambassadors from Goodyear.
Well, it was just about pit stop time anyway, so it worked out perfectly, this caution did.
Yeah, and there was a bunch of good race cars fixing to go a lap down. You see the cleanup crew out there fixing to go get the debris off the racetrack.
Probably nobody wanted to see this more than Dale Jarrett. With that piece of plastic covering part of that radiator opening, this is a very timely caution flag for our race leader.
Well, it is. Now, two cars, you talk about cars about to go a lap down, buddy. Two cars did get lapped just before the caution came out. They were Jeffrey Bodine and Steve Park. Now, Bobby Hamilton was already a couple of laps down, but all of the other 40 drivers are on the lead lap. And so everybody will be coming into the pits. Ralph?
And Steve Park are just about down.
They get ready to come down on pit road. There is a set limit on the tack as to what the drivers need to be at to be on the pit road speed. Well, the folks at Autometer, since there are no speedometers in the cars, have come up with this light system. This light will be on the dash. When you're not at the suggested speed limit, which is 3,600 RPMs, it'll be red. When you're at the right slot, it'll go to green. Dick?
Dale Jarrett is going to change four tires, put two cans of fuel in the car. They're only making a one-pound air adjustment in the back tires to try to give it some additional grip. He made that stop in a little over 16 seconds. To Bill.
Bill Elliott, halfway through his pit stop, they'll put a pound of air in the right rear, take a pound of air out of each left side tire, fuel, and away he goes.
Lock jam at the end of pit road. Car's trying to get out. New midseason rules, those right side tires have to be carried back over toward the wall, and one of them got away. That one's rolled away.
Yep, somebody will have a big penalty for that.
All the lead lap cars pitting this time by. Lap down cars will pit next time around. And leaders coming back out, Jarrett and Rusty Wallace. Again, gets fast service, and he's going to pick up a bit on these pit stops under caution. CBS Sports coverage of the Pepsi 400 continues after this message and a word from your CBS station.
CBS Sports presentation of the Pepsi 400 is sponsored by Doc Otis, a new flavored alcohol malt beverage. Real lemon, real refreshment. Unlock the Doc. www.wrenchhead.com. Parts online all the time. And by Outback Steakhouse. No rules, just right.
Welcome back to the Pepsi 400 at Daytona. On the left, Robin Pemberton, crew chief for Rusty Wallace. discussing with the NASCAR official, racing's version of the umpire, that he was not going too fast exiting the pits. Dick Bergeron?
Well, have you ever been in a crowd at an interstate highway and the radar picks you up for a speeding ticket and you're in a group of about 8 or 10 different cars and you say, hey, I was just traveling no faster than anybody else? And that is Robin Pemberton's argument. He said we were going no faster than anybody else. We just followed the 88 car down pit road. He is obviously very upset. You can see it. Mike?
Well, a lap to go, and he'll have to drop to the end of the longest line, I believe. Now, watch on the right, lower right of your screen, Ed Barrier's car. The right front tire is going to roll away right out here. The tire carrier looked like he went to try to get it. Then he saw he had to get back around to the other side, and that is going to be a problem for the Junie Donlevy team. Show you how it should work, our Fritos animation, as Barrier comes in to serve his penalty. Let's have a look at how a pit stop ought to work. The silver character is the NASCAR official as the crew goes around to service the car. Right side tires come off. The first 11-gallon can, gravity-fed, gasoline going in. Tires returned over the pit wall or to the pit wall. Now we've had 9 seconds elapsed. Second can of gas is either exchanged to the fueler or a different man comes over the wall with that second can. Left side, the car is up in the air, down and away in under 17 seconds. Dale Jarrett came in first, went out first. Tony Stewart in second, out fourth. Elliott held third. Jeff Burton lost a spot because Rusty Wallace gained four of them. But as Dick pointed out, a penalty for Wallace for being too fast exiting the pits down pit road. Now here on the back straightaway, you'll see at the top where a second group of spotters are stationed. There's a group right above us up on the roof of the Winston Tower, and here's another group of spotters on the backstretch.
Because it is so difficult under the lights here, and especially as big as this racetrack is, for them to identify their cars, for the spotters on the front side to identify them on the back side. So they have another set of spotters over there on the backstretch to just help identify the cars.
Hard to imagine given the vastness of this place, but they're stationed almost a half a mile from us over across the track.
You know, somebody that had a killer stop that time was Jeff Gordon. He's all the way up to ninth spot now.
And with the penalty to Wallace, he'll move to eighth, buddy, for the restart. Jarrett's Ford, Bill Elliott's Ford, Tony Stewart's Pontiac when they come down. Here's Bill Stevens.
Mike, one of the things we may want to watch on the restart is how Bill Elliott can get up to speed and stay there. The temperature in his engine went way over 250 on the pit stop, but then went back down again when he got up to speed. But he did tell his crew he's concerned.
Back under green after four caution laps, debris in turn two, and pit stops by everyone.
So they're good to go another 53 to 55, and maybe some of them even 60 laps before they'll have to come in again for fuel. Bill Elliott wants the lead.
He's going to get it.
Here comes Tony Stewart. He's looking on the inside there, trying to get by Jarrett on the inside, along with Jeff Burton as they go through turn three towards turn four.
That's what the drafting can do. A couple of cars hook up together and got a run on BJ, and he's falling back.
He has no friends.
No friends out there.
Mark Martin goes by.
Dale Earnhardt
trying to get by, not quite making it yet. Johnny Benson there in that solid white car pushing Earnhardt, trying to get by Jarrett, and just behind him, Jeff Gordon.
Boy, that's what happens when you're the dominant car and they get a chance to boot you upstairs. You're not going to find a hole in that bottom lane easily.
Boy, he'd be my friend, though. If I was back here, if I was Earnhardt and those guys, I'd get with that 88 and try to hook up and go back towards the front.
Well, you know, you'd think that they might do that, but
they are.
Now Johnny Benson decided he'd do that. He heard you, buddy.
Benson was Earnhardt's friend a minute ago, took his marbles, moved upstairs to line up with Dale Jarrett. Jeff Gordon up and in that pack now. Remember, he won Talladega from further back than he started tonight. He's right behind Earnhardt.
Ned said at the first of the show tonight that how important a great pit crew was, and that just proved it right there. Gordon back way back in 27th spot just before the pit stop there. Now he's all the way back up in the front group.
Bill Elliott has now led five races this year, but only a total of eight laps so far. He is on point right now. He had a bullet here in Daytona, but they built this car, proclaimed it better than the car that he ran up front with most of the day at Daytona. Here's Rusty Wallace, who served that penalty and restarted in 40th position. He's gained five spots in that blue number two.
And that's his brother just behind him, Kenny Wallace, there in the 55. I'm sure they'll try to help each other going up through this crowd, but you can see right there, there's no racing room.
Two, three deep back there in that group, so it doesn't leave a lot of room anywhere on the racetrack. Dick Berkman.
Well, this morning when the teams were getting ready to go into the garage, I had a conversation with Eddie DeHaan. He is the team manager for Bill Elliott, and he said to me, this is the best chance we have all year to win. This is our very best car. They are leading the race. There is, however, concern about overheating. And Gordon, if you're wondering, did he take just two tires? He did not. He had a killer stop, took four tires, and passed all those cars on pit road. To Bill Stevens.
Well, Mike Cram and Kevin Cram, and Mike Ford, the crew chiefs for Bill Elliott, think they know why that engine got so hot on the pit stop. After Bill left the pits, they noticed some rubber had fallen out of that grill underneath the fascia of the front of that car. They think it may have blocked the radiator. Now he's okay.
Being out front in the wind will help as Bill Elliott's Ford leads Tony Stewart.
It'll definitely help. He's getting all fresh air out there in front of him.
Now, buddy, Tony Stewart has spent most of this race in second place. Now, why would he be content to ride behind one of those Fords?
I talked to him a lot in the garage area this week, and he says, you know what? I'm going to school every time I go to one of these restricted plate races, and I'm learning every time I go out there. And who can I learn best from? The best in the business, and that's what he's doing right now. Bill Elliott, one time, was the greatest guy on super speedways, so he's learning as he's going along. He has a good car also.
This is only Stewart's seventh restrictor plate race. His whole short track career and his Busch Grand National career, he's run foot to the floor, lap after lap. So the idea of running with engine restrictions is relatively new to Tony Stewart. There he is in second place in that Joe Gibbs Pontiac. He's outspoken, he's brash, but he runs hard.
He does run hard.
Oh, look at this back here. Earnhardt cutting everybody off. Gordon had a look to the inside there. Earnhardt just came right across the racetrack and took it away.
Well, that's the second group of cars which are losing ground to those six cars that are running up front that are running in single file. They're racing back here. Earnhardt is in the seventh position. Jeff Gordon is eighth. And those cars running side by side, they need to single out or they're going to lose the draft again.
Tony Stewart in second place behind Bill Elliott. As we mentioned, restrictor plate racing is somewhat new to Stewart. We asked him what he thought of running restricted here at Daytona and at Talladega.
Of all the racing that we do in Winston Cup, the restrictor plate racing is my least favorite. It's like a 195 mile an hour chess match, and I'm terrible at chess. My second move of the day is I bring the queen out and I try to kill everything at once with a queen. So that's where I get in trouble with restrictor plate racing, because a lot of times I'm not patient enough and a lot of times I don't know when it's time to go.
I'd say tonight he knows. He's playing those pawns and rooks and knights. I'm going to keep that queen in his pocket for a while.
Yes, sir. He's doing a great job.
You can see the pit crew down there. They sweat along with the driver.
There are those six cars beginning to pull away. It's Elliott, Stewart, Jeff Burton, Mark Martin, Dale Jarrett, and Johnny Benson.
And Johnny Benson is hanging tough. But this second group right here, Earnhardt, Gordon, and Skinner, they are really hooked up now. They're trying to run down the front group. If they get up there, you talk about a race now, we're going to have one.
Now, this gap right there is 1.2 seconds from the first to the second pack. That's about a football field. Watching from the Lowe's onboard cam of Mike Skinner. Look at Jeff Gordon bounce around there.
Yes, but he's just tacked right to the back of Earnhardt's car. You can't even see it up there. That's how close they are. And they're actually buck drafting down the straightaways right now, trying to catch that front group.
And the car right behind Skinner is Earnhardt Jr. That'd be the 10th place car. Then Jimmy Spencer, Ricky Rudd, Ward Burton, Bobby Labonte, and Michael Waltrip in 15th. From Jeff Gordon, here is Mike Skinner's Chevrolet.
And every once in a while, you can see Dale Earnhardt Jr.'s little red nose on that Chevrolet sticking out there. That's him just back there on the left-hand side of the screen.
See, these cars are running over 188 miles an hour now with those fresher tires on them. Bill Elliott's pulling that train pretty fast.
Now, Earnhardt Jr. pulled to the outside down that straightaway to breathe the car, get out of the draft. Why?
I think he's cooling the motor down and also taking a little pressure off the tires, trying to make the car last longer on the tires, not leaning on quite as hard as maybe a person that runs right around the base of the racetrack.
He has a car length on Jimmy Spencer, then Ricky Rudd behind him. We've completed 66 laps at Daytona in the Pepsi 400. Plus, for two of the survivors, real life wasn't enough. What price will these TV survivors pay for fame? 48 hours, all new Wednesday on CBS. 70 laps, 170 some miles, 3 seconds from sixth back to seventh, and then a distance back to this group, Earnhardt Gordon, Earnhardt Jr. and Rudd pulling this second train. Elliott continues to lead Stewart's Pontiac and Jeff Burton's Ford.
And they're gradually inching away from this second group of cars led by Dale Earnhardt, Mike. Just every lap, they're getting about a tenth to two-tenths of a second away, but that front group is absolutely running a single file. Now, Jeff Gordon and Dale Earnhardt have been running a single file back there, but, buddy, there's a lot of racing going on behind them, which is sort of holding them back.
It is. It's like a big parachute back in there. Those cars running back there actually have a vacuum on the cars ahead of them. So as long as that group keeps on racing like that, that front group, that front group has already said, we're going to stay nose to tail as long as we can right now and try to get away from this big group.
Looking back from the Texaco Haviland cam on board Ricky Rudd in 12th place, Mike Skinner comes up trying to take 12th away.
Jimmy Spencer, car number 26.
The speed differential between those cars, only 2 or 3 miles an hour. Doesn't look from that view like they're going 190, but they are.
All you got to do is look up at that fence up there. Those are big posts that are going by there. They're separated about 25 yards apart, and you can tell they're going when you look at that.
From Skinner, that's Ward Burton in the Bill Davis number 22 Pontiac. Behind him, Rudd now, and here comes Mr. Excitement, Jimmy Spencer, and Dale Earnhardt Jr., who must have had a fun night so far because he's been side by side with somebody for most of it.
And Mike Waltrip right down here is now moving up on that group also.
Michael Waltrip had to take a provisional to get into this race. He is up to 15th.
And Spencer came by, got a run off the turn and passed Junior, Dale Earnhardt Jr. back.
Unscheduled stop for Kevin LePage, one of the Jack Roush Fords on pit road, way too early for a scheduled pit stop. And the crew comes over to have a look underneath the right side.
They brought jack stands out there. They're going to jack it up and try to find out what the problem is.
Up front, the last car in that six-car train is Cinderella once again. Johnny Benson led 39 laps this February in the Daytona 500 and was leading with 4 laps to go when the Fords freight trained him, and Benson is back, fashioning a new glass slipper. And there he is, right in the lead pack. A little further back, seventh place.
Well, Gordon decided maybe he can run faster than Earnhardt because that sixth up front is running away from them. He's trying to make a pass. Mike Skinner, Earnhardt's teammate, is going to try to help Gordon a little bit.
And right on back through there, you can see Ward Burton and so many of the guys coming in there. Bobby Labonte now trying to get a draft going on the outside of with Earnhardt there as they move way up on the racetrack, taking that high line around the racetrack.
From Jeff Gordon, looking at Earnhardt.
Looking at two cars go by.
Bobby Labonte. And from Labonte, looking back at Ward Burton. Tell you how hard it is to pass in this pack. Rusty Wallace has one of the fastest cars here. Restarted 40th. Has only been able to gain 11 positions since they waved the green flag once again. He's 29th.
Well, and Jeff Gordon's dropping back right now. He has no one with him there, and these guys are just freight training right on by him.
There's the lead pack. Here is the interval. 5 seconds. Back to this second group that just will not seem to go single file. Well, they're three wide again. Buddy it has to be very frustrating to sit behind a car when you know you've got more accelerator pedal and you think you can get by.
Yeah, and you just have to wait for that right opportunity, because just making a move, if it's not the right one, all you do is just frustrate yourself by going out there and not making the pass. So you have to wait on a good ride to go by.
A lot of frustration in that pack right now, then, as our Fritos telemetry shows Michael Waltrip's speed and RPM.
There's Terry Labonte in the 5 car. He's running pretty high on the racetrack. I've noticed a lot of the cars are moving that groove up a little bit now, because the high side of the racetrack is fresher than the bottom part, and it's getting rubber and oil build up around the bottom of the racetrack.
76 laps complete. Dick Berger.
The radio chatter between the drivers in that big pack up front, those top 6 cars and their spotters, is this. They want each other to stay in line. They figure if they all can stay in line, that they'll open up some increasing distance on that black number 3. That's the name we keep hearing, Earnhardt. They don't want to mess with him. Why? Earnhardt has been the most successful driver in restrictor plate history. So far, so good. It's working. They are opening additional space, but it may not work much longer. Dale Jarrett, for one, just radioed his crew and said, my oil temperature and water temperature are climbing, and that's what happens when you run in a tight pack. Mike?
Well, Dale Earnhardt is 6.5 seconds off the lead, which is a little like saying Tiger Woods is 6 strokes off the lead. There's still plenty of time. 77 laps complete as we're coming up on halfway in the Pepsi 400 at Daytona.
Naked man.
Tonight's aerial shots from the Goodyear Blimp Stars and Stripes. At the controls, Captain Dan Thomas, Goodyear exclusive tire supplier to the NASCAR Winston Cup Series. Third time under the lights for the Pepsi 400. We are halfway, 80 laps, 200 miles complete. Leaders have included Dale Jarrett, Tony Stewart for 1 lap under the caution, and Bill Elliott, who is the man out front right now. Tony Stewart in second, Jeff Burton in third, Mark Martin and Dale Jarrett, and Johnny Benson in that unsponsored white Pontiac. That's the lead draft, 6 cars strong. Trouble, big trouble, front straightaway, a car. Michael Waltrip hard in the wall.
Terry Labonte also up against the wall there.
Oh, and Waltrip gets slammed by Jeremy Mayfield. Caution is out, and Michael Waltrip took a wild ride.
Mayfield, he's got a lot of damage to his Ford.
Waltrip, okay.
Boy, that's good to see. I mean, he really got whacked.
Terry Labonte, who with Waltrip took provisional spots to get into this field, against the wall.
I can see Terry moving around inside the car there.
And his Chevrolet is really damaged too much. Jeremy Mayfield's going to try to get his car back to the garage area and see if they can make some repairs on it.
Yeah, and I think that one's had it for the night. He may get it back, but I don't think that one's going anywhere.
A wild ride for Michael Waltrip. Unhappy with his car in qualifying and with practice, was running well in the lead pack here tonight. He is okay. It was Waltrip spinning, slamming the wall.
He wants to know whether Labonte's okay. He's looking across the racetrack there,
trying to get a signal from Terry. Labonte piled in, and then Mayfield, as Waltrip's car slid down to the inside. 2-time Winston Cup champion Terry Labonte talking with the track crew. Get in there to help. And Jeremy Mayfield climbing out.
Tried to get back around, but he could not. So he's climbing out of his battered Ford. It's nice of him to lift that tailgate down, give him a place to sit down.
Yeah.
Michael Waltrip going over to see if he can be of assistance as Terry Labonte tries to get out of his Chevrolet. And let's see what happened. Watch the 7 car of Michael Waltrip.
Okay, there. Well, there's Terry going around. He makes contact with the seven car there of Walter. Now, what triggered that? I'm not sure.
There were some reports there was oil on the track, and there's Mayfield, pow, right into Waltrip. Trying to run through the smoke. And so three cars are knocked out of this race. Here's a different view.
Now Michael comes back down, clips the 32 car, and then wham, the 12 car of Jeremy Mayfield right into it.
I do not know how Scott Pruitt in the 32 made it through there, because there was contact and he did a great job of keeping that car straight. Jeremy Mayfield not so lucky.
I'm not sure what turned Terry Labonte around.
I'm not either. I was watching right through the middle part of the trioval there. The five car gets away. Look at Pruitt, though, fighting that thing. A lot of damage to the right rear corner of Pruitt's car, but he managed to keep it straight.
Yeah, he got hit pretty hard. And I think Mayfield thought he saw a hole there, but when Michael Waltrip hit the 32 car of Scott Pruitt, that shoved him right down in front of Mayfield.
It's already started here.
Yeah, that's Michael in front there, but Terry Labonte in this car right here already around backwards. He lost control there in the middle part, and there was some people reporting there was oil through the trioval.
And Terry Labonte has climbed out of his car.
All right.
And that is certainly great news, that he is shaken, stirred, but okay. Michael Waltrip showing his Boston Marathon running form as he sprints back to the pits.
It's good to see Terry Labonte walking across the racetrack, now being carried.
And a big cheer from the crowd that Labonte is okay. Let's have another look at this replay and see if we can see what turns that yellow number five Chevrolet of Labonte around. Look way on the right side of your screen. There he is. Did he and Waltrip maybe make contact?
I think so. I think he got into the right rear corner of the five car, turning Terry sideways, and then Terry made contact later on trying to get the car back straight. He hit Waltrip, and both of them get around like that.
And I wasn't kidding about Michael Waltrip in the Boston Marathon. He passed 4,000 runners, completing the 26.2 miles in Boston.
I was impressed, first of all, that he entered it and then that he finished it.
From trackside. From Ricky Rudd. You see, you heard Rudd as he went past, got his foot right back in it, wanted to get as far away from that as possible.
Well, that one shot there did show Michael Waltrip just touching the back of the five car Terry Labonte in the middle of trioval there. And I tell you, if you could physically get your hand out there and grab hold of the quarter panel through that area, you could turn a car around. That's how light they are through that area.
A three car accident, Michael Waltrip, Terry Labonte, and Jeremy Mayfield have put us under the second caution flag of the night. We've completed 84 laps. We are just past halfway. Pit road will probably open in the next lap or so. It's not time for scheduled pit stops, but many teams will take the opportunity to come in under the caution.
I believe most of them will, Mike.
Mayfield's car hauled to the garage, so is Labonte's.
And you can see that damage on Scott Pruitt's car, so he definitely will be in the pits.
You know, while we're just talking about that, there was report of oil on this front straightaway. If Terry backed off a little bit because of oil, that would have been enough just to get the two together there.
Pit road will open this time. We'll have a look, see if the track truck comes out, puts any speedy dry down along the front straightaway. And here is Scott Pruitt, the ex-IMSA and IndyCar racer. And you can see the right rear quarter panel torn up pretty good. Oh, excuse me. That's bad English. Torn up pretty bad.
Yeah, exactly.
From the collision there with Michael Waltrip.
There's a lot of damage there.
Well, it's
sure.
Feeding time at the zoo. Pit road's open. Dick Berggren.
Dale Jarrett came skidding to a stop here. It ought to take the fuel man, Steve Allen, about 12 seconds to put two cans of gas in. It'll take longer than that for Mike Power to change the front tires and Kevin Gilman to change the rear tires. Tire changers are the limiting factor. 22 car
Gaines will put Burton out front. Bill?
Just completed his pit stop. Mike took four tires, added a pound of air to the right front. They're still a little bit tight on that car. They're trying to loosen it up. He took fuel and got on out of here.
Bill Elliott. Bill Stevens was speaking up. He came in as the race leader. And we are under caution with pit stops concluded. CBS Sports coverage of the Pepsi 400 will continue after this message and a word from your local station. Coming this Wednesday, just past halfway at Daytona International Speedway in the third nighttime running of the Pepsi 400. Kenny Irwin did not pit. He's our race leader. Ward Burton, a two-tire change, has put him in second place. And up here, high above the speedway, we're surviving pretty well. Nobody's been voted out of the booth just yet. Haven't had any bugs.
Not yet, yes.
But they've had some bugs in the grills of those cars at 190 miles an hour. The Fords have been up front. But how about Johnny Benson up there with all those big buck teams once again?
Smoke and mirrors. It has to be. I mean, this kid, you know, was booted out of a ride year before last, and all of a sudden he gets a good chance for the Tyler Jet car. No sponsor down here in February. Almost pulled off Daytona 500. And tonight, he hadn't been out of the top five in a long time.
Well, he's had one other Pontiac with him up there in that lead draft, Tony Stewart. But, Ned, this is deja vu all over again, Daytona. Are those fast Fords going to gang up on those Pontiacs?
I don't know if they can or not, Mike. We've seen, you know, some cars be able to pull away from others working together, whether it's a Ford or Pontiac or whatever it is. Now, you know, DJ dropped back there to fifth. I don't know if he had anything that he could come back up through there with or not. He certainly would have had to have a lot of help. And so it's going to be interesting when we get down that last 100 miles.
One thing we found in the Daytona 500, you get down to the last five laps, you have no friends. We're under the second caution of the night in the Pepsi 400. Daytona at the speed of light continues after this. Raj and Dick Bergeron.
And I'm with Michael Waltrip. Well, it could have been worse in February in the Busch Series race. You wound up upside down in almost the same place, but what happened this time?
Terry spun out. I mean, I don't know what happened. I thought maybe he blew a tire, but I got over there and looked and checked on him. He's fine, and all four Goodyears were up, so he must have broke something because he just turned around. I took the little Nations Rent Chevy wide, and I just hoped that I would make it through, and I didn't. But we'll be back at Loudon. I'm a survivor, and I want to get on that show, too. That would be really cool. And if that doesn't work out, I'm real concerned about what I'm going to do in the future because my new car owner, Jimmy Smith, is doing everything for this team. I had it right behind the two-time champion, Terry Labonte, going to the front. A great run for our Ultra Motorsports team and wind up crash, Dick. Shame.
Hey, what's it like out there right now?
It wasn't bad. Talladega was a nightmare, but this place has a tendency to separate the cars because of the handling that you need. Cars were pushing. Tons of people were pushing, so they would run high, but it's slower on the bottom, so the guys that were handling well couldn't complete the pass. So it was more of a handling race, a dicing race, and that's what race car drivers want. They want the job in their hands, and tonight it was in the driver's hands.
We're glad to see you're okay. Mike?
We're going back to green. Kenny Irwin did eventually make a pit stop, so he has fallen off the lead, and Ward Burton, who came into the pits 12th, came out first because of a two-tire change, and that's Burton on the outside in black and yellow, leading the back to turn one.
We'll see how that works out with two tires. Hasn't been that long since they changed all four tires, but most of the time, you need fresh rubber all the way around. We'll see how it works here as we get wound up and get that speed up.
225 of the 400 miles complete next time by. Ralph Shaheen.
Well, the Joe Gibbs crew for Tony Stewart had another great stop, Mike, a 15:40, which got him back out front up quick. They also made two small adjustments to the car. He's a little tight coming off the corner, but more importantly, Tony feels great behind the wheel of the car tonight. The last couple of weeks, he's been suffering from some heat. He says, guys, everything's nice and cool in the car. I'm just cruising along right now.
You're riding with him in fourth place. Jeff Burton just ahead.
And behind him, Jeff Gordon got it beside of Bobby Hamilton through turns three and four. Cost him a lot of distance there. He was trying to hang on to the leaders, but already they pulled away. Just that one little bit, a half a lap side by side. And it wasn't, you know, Hamilton was down on the inside, but Gordon just got hung up there for a little bit. As a result, the five top cars pulled away.
Here comes Earnhardt on the bottom side, and you can see the six car there coming right along with him. They have a pretty fast draft right now, and Gordon going straight backward.
Well, Let's go back to the garage area, Dick Bergman.
Well, just checked on Terry Labonte. He is okay, Mike. A little bit disoriented. He was knocked out in the car, and as a result, as a precautionary measure, they're going to transport him to the local Halifax hospital here. Okay, but leaving the racetrack.
Thanks, Dick. Pontiac, Ford. Ford, Pontiac, Ford. And then the Chevrolets, Earnhardt in sixth place, the first of the Chevys, Skinner in eighth in a Chevy, and Earnhardt Jr. in 10th, and Gordon 11th.
I think the best chance they've had all night long to run that front group down, because I don't believe that Warburton is as fast as the Fords when they're all hooked up together. And if Earnhardt and Gordon and that bunch are going to catch up, plus this is their best shot.
Yeah, they have a fast car back there with them that they didn't have before in the way of Mark Hart. How much he can help them, I don't know. But Mark was up there in that front pack before this pit stop, this last pit round of pit stop. So he might be able to help pull him up there as well, although he's pushing Earnhardt right now, not pulling.
Well, Ned, the leader's last lap is faster than before these pit stops. New tires are a help. 189.4 miles an hour last time by for Ward Burton. So the race pace has picked up since these pit stops.
Definitely has.
Well, you would expect that. It's getting cooler right now, and they're also adjusting on these cars, so they will get faster as the night goes along.
Bill Stevens?
Mike, during that last pit stop, Mike Ford, the crew chief for Bill Elliott, had a little chat with Frank Starter, the crew chief for Jeff Burton, and they decided they would run together, try to track down Ward Burton. The irony here is that back in February in the Daytona 500, those two guys finished second and third. They've done this before.
Elliott goes to the lead, drops to the bottom to pick up Burton's 99, leaves Burton's older brother hung out to dry on the high side.
Boy, I could almost call that shot. And now watch Ward and Jeff and all this bunch right now, but Ward is just dropping right straight back. He was leading just a second ago, and he's sitting back in fifth.
Well, he's up there in the point standings, and he got 5 bonus points for leading. And so that will help him some if he can hang on to the draft here now. He's still in real good shape.
Next Sunday, the series continues on the mile of Loudoun, New Hampshire. Very different racetrack from this one.
Now, look what happened there. Earnhardt has run down the Burton now, and he's up with the front group. They've been trying not to get that three car up there with him, but he's up there now.
When they made that pass, when they were too wide there for about a lap, all those cars going by Ward Burton, boy, that opened up a big, wide space of air there that Earnhardt, he picked up that draft, and nobody knows how to do it better.
That pass got Bill Elliott the lead, but it also got him lots of company. This is not just a 5-car race anymore. Look at that pack. That goes all the way back through at least 10th, 11th place. Last car in the train, the caboose, is Bobby Labonte. Then Jeff Gordon in 12th place. The 24 leads the second pack.
And Jeff Gordon has some good help there because Rusty Wallace is right behind him, so they should run this front group down and make it a 20-car group.
Now Rusty Wallace has moved all the way up to 13th now from that penalty that he had during that other caution and sent him all the way to the back of the pack. So he has made some good gains up through the field, and his pit crew helped him to do that.
You know, a hornet won't bother you unless you swat at him. And then he comes after you with a vengeance, and that's what Rusty Wallace is doing right now. He served that penalty for going too fast, leaving his pit, and he's storming back to the front. And he's getting there.
As a fast race car and mission, he's on a mission. I want to mention, Mike, Rick Mast was just about to go a lap down before that caution. He was not more than 100 yards in front of Bill Elliott, who was leading the race. Caution came out at a perfect time. Another lap, he'd have been a lap down. But now Mast is up to the 35th position.
And you're riding with him right now, coming off turn 4. You can see the sparks flying off these cars. That's just the exhaust systems on these cars just touching as they go through the corners.
Seiko onboard cam with Rick Mast. That is Darrell Waltrip just ahead. Waltrip in his final season as a Winston Cup driver, making his 55th career Winston Cup start here at Daytona. And Waltrip in 34th is the wrenchhead.com telemetry onboard Rick Mast.
About 6,700 RPMs as he comes off the corner and down the back straightaway.
Well, those cars got the racing back behind. See, they lost a little bit of space there. Ward Burton dropping back again. He's the car up on the outside. Earnhardt now has moved up to the fifth position, has Mark Martin right on his bumper. And remember, Mark Martin has a fast car.
And if you have a fast car behind you, it's almost like having one in front of you. He can actually push you along because he's not dragging back as you start off in the corners.
Good look, point.
Look at that 22 of Ward Burton, the black and yellow car. He got up on the high side by himself, and he just got clotheslined. The whole group moved underneath him on the low side. Slow car down at turn one. One car very slow off the pace down the bottom of the racetrack.
I think that's Kevin LePage that just came out of the pits, Mike.
Thanks,
man. He's headed trying to get his speed up.
Dale Earnhardt Jr. leading
Bobby Labonte. Coming by Ward Burton.
Let's have a look back for Joe Niemicek. Alfredo is on board telemetry with Niemicek in 14th position, number 33.
There's this car right in there.
Get a few extra 100 RPM in a tight draft there with Ward Burton.
Somebody is not moving up at all that I'm surprised as the 24 Jeff Gordon. He's got good drafting help there with Rusty Wallace, but he's just not coming up like I thought he would.
That's been a surprise to me also, buddy. I thought that he would be better than what he has been so far.
Closing down on 100 laps, 160 make up the race tonight. You're watching the Pepsi 400 on CBS.
Cars remain in the lead lap with 99 laps complete, 247 and a half of the 400 miles. Leaders 5, lead changes 6, speed down to 155 miles an hour after a couple of cautions for 11 laps. Three cars have retired from the event. Terry Labonte and Michael Waltrip. Jeremy Mayfield's car has also crashed out of it. There's a question if Kevin LePage will be getting back into the story. But the big story now continues to be Earnhardt closing in the field. And Bill Elliott, 177 races since he won his last one at Darlington in the Southern 500 in 1994 for Junior Johnson. Leading the way, pacing this field again here at Daytona in a race he has won twice previously. Let's go back topside with Mike Joy.
Thanks, Ken. The big news is that second pack, and this the third pack as they battle. But Dale Earnhardt is pulling that second four-car train right up toward the leaders as they roll off turn four. This is the group right behind them. As Jeff Gordon continues to fight, there's that second pack of four. Earnhardt, Mark Martin, Mike Skinner, and that tenacious Johnny Benson trying to get to the leaders. Upper left of your screen, those positions in red, like Rusty Wallace, lost a spot last lap. Wally Dahlebach there gained one. That's why his position is shown in green on our scoring rundown. Well, we took the vote here in the booth, and Buddy Baker's been voted out of Daytona Beach. Onto a 7 a.m. plane to go to Milwaukee to broadcast the Milwaukee 250 Busch Grand National race tomorrow on CBS.
Love the Busch racing, but right now we have a pretty good race going on here. Even though these cars right now are kind of spaced out and they're very similar in speed, the first four cars there, they have not raced at all. They have stayed nose to tail, just like the second group, running just behind them, and they're running about the same speed every lap, Ned.
About the same speed. The last couple of laps, Bill Elliott has opened the gap by about 0.04 of a second each lap, the last two laps. It's a little over a second now that Earnhardt is behind, but he's beginning to lose, and each lap goes by, if they pick up that much, that gap will widen even more.
Now it's Earnhardt right here leading this second group. It's trouble. Scott Pruitt, big trouble in turn one. The front of that car used up. Damage on the left rear corner, and caution is out for the third time tonight.
Boy, this will change things all around now.
What it'll do is going to put them in a position that will race back to the flag here, but it'll put them in position they can probably go the rest of the way on a tank of fuel. It'll be close.
Boy, Scott Pruitt hit pretty hard. Not hard enough to keep him from driving that car back to the garage and onto the truck. Because that one looks pretty done for tonight.
I'd say.
It's only the third caution tonight. The first came for debris at lap 54. Michael Waltrip, Terry Labonte got together and collected Jeremy Mayfield at lap 81. And this caution comes at lap 105. Scott Pruitt, IndyCar star, but Winston Cup rookie for Cal Wells. And he's going to limp that one home to the garage area.
A lot of fluid coming out from underneath that car. And but you see all that damage. Of course, he was in that accident also. He had damage from the accident with Terry Labonte and Michael Waltrip.
And as you see, the fluid's running out there. The one nice thing he's doing is he is on the service road there down the back straightaway. So the racing groove is just up there where the yellow line is. So he's not creating a problem for anyone out there but himself right now.
Here's the tail end of it as Pruitt's around and nose into the wall in turn one. Wow. The right rear tire looked down, but not sure if that was what precipitated the accident or the result of it.
Well, he had some damage to the car to the right rear corner in a wreck previous to this, so it might have been something related.
Could have been.
Out of the race, Terry Labonte, Michael Waltrip, Jeremy Mayfield, Kevin LePage laps down but back out after an early trip to the garage. Everyone else still running. And 35 cars of the 43 starters are still on the lead lap.
And they'll be coming down pit road right now, Mike.
Led by Bill Elliott, Jeff Burton, Tony Stewart, and Dale Jarrett. Bill Stevens.
Bill Elliott is coming down pit road right now. The drive-through crew poised and ready. They just had a team huddle. They are psyched up for this pit stop. And crew chief Kevin Cram just told me that if they get both cans of fuel completely into the car, they will be able to go the rest of the race. They will do four tires. They seem to have the handling sorted out. They will make no adjustments. The right side tires are on. Here come the two on the left side. It's a clean pit stop. Tires are not loose. Let's go to Dick Berger.
Long stop for Dale Jarrett. Big problems on the right rear. Kevin Gilman spent forever on the right rear tire just trying to get it back on again. Tough stop for Long. 7 stop for the 88. Tough stop for Dale Jarrett, who had dominated this race today.
And Dick, a heartbreaker for Ed Barrier in Junie Donlevy's car. He was trying to get into his pit as Matt Kenseth was coming out and Bill Elliott. Barrier could not get into his pit. He came in 22nd. He's going to have to go all the way around and come in again to make his stop, and he'll be 35th. 106 laps complete. Jarrett's pit stop, 31.7 seconds. We'll be back in a moment. From the Goodyear blimp behind the pace car right there, race leader Darrell Waltrip, leading his 403rd career Winston Cup race. And our thanks to the aerial crew of the blimp Stars and Stripes as Goodyear celebrates 75 years with its airship fleet, bringing you those high-in-the-sky views of Daytona International Speedway. After tonight's race, get online for complete Winston Cup point standings and check out the photo gallery. Just click on auto racing at cbs.sportsline.com. AOL users, keyword CBS Sportsline. This Wednesday on CBS, 10 strangers will move into a house with cameras recording their every move, and you, the viewers, decide who stays and who goes. The last one left gets fame and fortune. Big Brother, right after Survivor, this Wednesday on CBS. So caution continues with Darrell Waltrip out in front of the Pepsi 400. We'll be right back. Front of the pack includes drivers who only took on two tires on this pit stop. Jeff Burton, Johnny Benson, Jeff Gordon, Rusty Wallace, Jimmy Spencer, Matt Kenseth. We're back under green. Around Steve Park, that yellow car one lap down, and the leaders form up in the outside lane. Here goes Benson for the lead,
and Jeff Gordon drops down in the 24 car there in the draft with him, and here goes Benson right into the lead.
Pontiac and a Chevrolet snookered the Ford of Jeff Burton, who gets clothesline,
and Rusty Wallace in the two car there in third spot,
and Jimmy Spencer up to fourth.
Now, all of those drivers just have two tires. Well, I should say two fresh tires. They all have four tires on them.
Look at Earnhardt on the inside, making his own way. Down on the bottom, eighth last time by.
And he has a good drafting partner there, just behind him there in the 20 car, Tony Stewart.
Bill Elliott got it from the outside. He was the dominant car, and then he got up on the outside, and the train went by and down on the inside.
Johnny B. Good, Johnny Benson, leading his first race since the Daytona 500. Sponsor hunting. I'd say this is a pretty good audition. Here's Ralph.
Mike, when Johnny Benson and his sister Barb were growing up in Grand Rapids, Michigan, their father, John Benson Sr., was racing cars. When Barb would get in trouble, she used to love to go to the track. Her dad would make her stay home on the weekends. But when Johnny would get in trouble, his dad would make him go to the racetrack and go to work on that race car. Dick Bergeron.
Ray Steinert is crew chief for Jeff Burton. He's one of the crew chiefs who called for just two tires. Why did you choose two instead of four?
Well, I'll tell you the truth, I really anticipated a lot of guys doing two. Didn't want to get ourselves back in the 10th, 15th position all night long. It's been a five-car breakaway. I really felt like it would be a five-car breakaway again here right on this restart. But some of these guys aren't, you know, don't use the head a lot, and sometimes they do. And, you know, if we get a five-car breakaway, great, but it don't look like we're going to.
It's a gamble, Mike.
And it doesn't look like they're going to indeed. Here comes Earnhardt.
Earnhardt, and he has Tony Stewart just behind him there. Jeff Gordon blocking the way there as Earnhardt makes a move to the inside.
And boy, look at Stewart hang right on with Earnhardt. He knows he's a good horse to ride behind, and so he's staying right there with him. Jeff Burton saw him coming, so he pulled down in front of Earnhardt.
Do a lot of mirror driving here. If you see a better car coming, you block the way and help push you along. Jeff Burton making the inside move on the 26 car there for Spencer down the back straightaway.
And Earnhardt comes with him. Benson drops to the inside to pick up Rusty Wallace.
Doing a smart move there. Very smart move by Johnny Benson. Not giving him room to make a run on him.
Daytona 500 all over again for Benson, but this time instead of four, there's still 48 laps to go.
Well, I don't have to tell you that their worst nightmare is there now. The three car, Dale Earnhardt, no longer is trying to make up any distance. He's there.
As they fight for the lead, Ken Squire.
Well, Wallace, too. Remember, he started out here in 12th, got penalized, went all the way to the rear, fought himself up into second, but whoops, there he goes, clotheslined and falling back. The Hornet has been somewhat detuned out there with that sting for the moment. Let's go to Ralph.
Kevin Hamlin is a crew chief for Dale Earnhardt.
Oh, trouble in the road is Elliott Hard. Bill Elliott Hard as they went three wide. Ricky Rod, I think, collects, or check that, Stacy Compton collects him, and Elliott's car, one of the fastest three here, is demolished.
Johnny Benson brings it back to the line.
Stacy Compton was the car that collected Elliott after it was nearly over, and Compton's race is. Elliott trying to become only the third owner driver to win this race. Jack Smith in 1960, Richard Petty in 75 and 77, and Elliott not tonight.
I believe Sterling Marlin was involved in it as well. He came by here very slowly.
Compton will not make it back to the garage.
He's getting out of his car. And here's Elliott coming out. That's good news.
He's okay.
Thank goodness. Waving to the fans.
They got three wide underneath him, Ned, and I think there was a little casual contact that somehow got up into Bill and got him to the wall.
Well, you have to know that at that far end of the back straightaway, there has to be contact for you to turn around like that. I mean, even going in a straight line and all of a sudden right up to the wall.
He well could have been standing in victory lane instead of in the track apron.
He's going to let you know who it is.
Yeah, he's not happy. He is not happy. We'll know in a moment who it was before we even see the replay. Like just pointed towards Mike Skinner. Not sure about that, but that was a car that looked like that his finger was pointing towards.
And Bill jumps into the ambulance for the mandatory ride to the care center. And it's our fourth caution of the night.
Pit road is closed at the moment because Stacy Compton's car is right at the entrance of pit road. I doubt if we'll see many cars come down pit road because they should be able to go the rest of the way on fuel, excepting maybe those that near the back that run through some of the wreck.
There's Stacy Compton. He is okay. Graduate of the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series, late model racing.
Well, Dale Earnhardt Jr. did come into the pits as we watch this. They hook up the record to Stacy Compton's Ford.
And the hood's up. Not a good sign.
So he has some problems deeper than needing fuel or gas.
Going to take some tape off of that grill to help cool that engine down, perhaps.
That'll mean he'll have to go to the end of the longest line for pitting before the pits were open.
And just up pit road from him, Sterling Marlin is in as well. We think Marlin may have received some damage in that incident in turn three.
Yeah, I think he did, because he was coming around the track pretty slowly. You see them working on the back end of the car. Somebody got into the back end of it. He probably slowed down and somebody hit him. So somebody probably has some front end damage.
Ned, they're taking that entire back valance off of that car. They're pulling it off as we speak right there. So he did get hit from behind.
So you got to figure somebody's got some front end damage then. He got hit from behind.
Well, Stacy Compton had the right front just about torn off the car. Let's figure out what happened on the back straightaway on lap 114.
There's Bill Elliott. He gets hit from behind by Mike Skinner, turning him right up into the wall. You can see everybody back there hoping he does not come back down the racetrack.
And here's another look. He's already up there. And here comes Compton. Knocks the right front into him. And this is Marlin. May have just been abrading the racetrack, sliding back up. That's a 31-degree degree ramp, and even the best SUV can't make that one without damage.
No, he got hit by the 97 car.
Chad Little got in him just a little bit. And he got all of the 9 car there. Stacy Compton got all his damage. He went straight up into the wall there. I would have to think he probably cut a tire down from some of the debris off of the other cars that he wrecked through there.
I'm wondering if the beginning of this wreck was when Mark Martin jumped 3 wide down to the inside. Could Bill Elliott have lifted and breathed the car and Skinner got in the back of him?
Well, let's see. There's Mark Martin coming on the inside of Ricky Rudd. And, well,
if Elliott lifted, certainly Skinner would have hit him. But the look on Elliott's face showed that he didn't. Only the two of them know for sure.
Yeah. Well, Gordon came in for a pit stop. And a couple of other cars as well.
Let's watch from Mike Skinner's car.
He did back out and throttled. You could hear him ease up there. And they just got together going down in turn three.
From Bobby Labonte.
Boy, he sees that car go out there. It's like, whew, man, I got through there.
Jeff Gordon. From Dale Jarrett.
He was back in 23rd position.
Man, oh man, he's got all 4 tires down below the yellow line there, Ned.
Yep, even changed gears and got on out of there.
4th caution of the night at Daytona, 44 laps to go. We'll be back with more after this. Forty-three to go, and working this 4th caution of the night means that Bobby Allison's 1980 race record is safe, 173.473 miles per hour, record speed for the 400 miles here in July. And we're getting set for the restart. And we'll be back to Daytona International Speedway. You're watching the Pepsi 400 on CBS Sports. 119 laps complete, 1 to go this time. We'll go back to green. Here's Bill Stevens.
Bill Elliott, looked like you were on a great run tonight, but when you got out of the car, you looked unhappy. What happened?
Well, I really don't know. It's just one of them deals that everybody got to racing and there's nowhere to go. I mean, and with the way the cars are right now, you can't pass down the straightaway. You got to handle through the corners. Everybody on fresh tires can run the corner. But then again, after they run a few laps, then the better cars pulled on away, and that's what I was just trying to wait on, was, you know, get sorted out, let everybody do it, get going. You know, the lap traffic kind of got me hung out there, let a group come on the inside, and everybody got to racing really hard down the back straightaway, and it's just one of them nights.
On the replay, we wondered if maybe you had pulled up on the throttle before the contact.
Well, I rolled. Mark was in the grass, and I was trying to give Mark a little bit of a break, but then nobody will give you a break. I guess that's racing.
1988 and 91 winner is out. To Ralph Shaheen.
Kevin Hamlin is the crew chief for Dale Earnhardt. Right now, you've got Jeff Burton in front of you, and you got Tony Stewart and Rusty Wallace behind you. Which car does Dale need to have running in front or behind him to get to the front?
Whichever one's the fastest. We're just going to play a chess game. Stay whichever way, you know. We're just going to have to play it by ear here when they take off. I mean, the 99 is probably going to make a run on the 10, and hopefully the 20 will follow us, and then we'll just keep on trucking. You know, we did four tires in 99, and 10's got two tires, and hopefully later in this run here, the GM Goodrich Service Plus Chevrolet will be pretty strong.
Dick Bergen.
The car that's in the lead with Johnny Benson driving is the ultimate underdog team. Without a sponsor, you cannot run successfully in Winston Cup racing. I asked him how long he could go without one. He said the plan is to go at least to Indianapolis. Benson likes his team so much, he wants these guys to stick together, even if they have to quit racing before then. One of the crew members just came up to me and said, you tell that CBS audience that somebody can get a whale of a deal on sponsoring a race car in about 40 or 50 laps. These guys don't even have uniforms with sponsored logos on it. They're all plain. Mike?
He is the leader, Johnny Benson. This is still anybody's race. This is a 2.5 mile chessboard. All the squares are black. And all the pieces are big ones. Here we go. We're back under green.
Jeff Burton down on the inside, making it three wide. Benson hung up on the outside. Earnhardt going with Burton.
Well, that returns the favor of the last restart when Benson dropped low under race leader Burton. Four wide. Didn't think they could do that here. This place is 10 feet narrower than Talladega.
Man.
That'll take your breath.
Yeah. Yes.
Look at Rusty Wallace. He looked like a rocket ship going in the corner there. He just went right on by the three car of Earnhardt.
And here comes Ricky Rudd. And Earnhardt's car going very high. I guess he had to there. That corner, his teammate Mike Skinner came up there behind him. Boy, look on back in the pack. They're still running two and three deep back there.
Can you hold your breath for 39 laps? That's how long it's going to take to settle this one.
Tony Stewart down on the bottom side there. They're three wide going into turn one.
Well, they know that, you know, the race is running out, and they got to get all they can get.
Johnny Benson had a terrible restart there. He's trying to regain a little momentum down the back straightaway, but where do you go?
Man, what, five?
Five wide. No, this can't work in turn three.
Well, they're going to have to get down to at least three.
And they did. This is chess. I'm taking my pieces and going home. This is unbelievable. Through the trial, the three abreast once again.
Yeah, and you just hope somebody does not make that critical error where you just make contact, because at this speed, all you have to do is touch someone, and it makes a terrible mess out of everything behind you.
Now, six cars have singled out at the front. Still three wide mid-pack. It wasn't so much Johnny Benson got a horrible restart, but he restarted on the outside. He's still on the outside. Stewart, they touched. They traded paint and survived.
Tony Stewart didn't have a choice, so he was down on the flat part of the racetrack. He just stayed wide open, hoping Jimmy Spencer would give him a little room. He had to take a little room.
Yeah, he had a run going, and he just couldn't get out of the throttle. He just barreled right on in there. Great move.
Ricky Rudd really on the move in the 28 car now.
Now that six car single file is seven, but the cars double file behind them are with them. And here comes Jarrett up the inside three wide in the 88.
They had pinching me every once in a while up here. As they go five wide, six wide down the back straightaway.
That's for about 13th that Jarrett moved into. He was 29th after he had his tire problem, that long pit stop.
Kenny Irwin. That green car ran the whole back straightaway on the apron to gain position.
How long can they keep it up?
With Dale Earnhardt Jr. Our bud Cam back there in 18th place. Kenny Wallace just ahead, 55.
Yeah, he's kind of in the middle lane there. Dale Jarrett
just in front. Robert Presley on the outside, 77. Here comes Wallace back.
Dale Earnhardt Jr. has done a good job since that restart because he was at the back of the pack. He made numerous pit stops during that caution period. But whatever was wrong, they must have gotten it fixed because he's coming back up through there.
He restarted 33rd, Ned, and he's up to 18th. The front pack single file cannot get away. That is surprising.
It is surprising with all these cars running side by side, two and three deep back there.
This is the race they came to see. Three abreast mid-pack, and now single file, just a little bit of a seven-car breakaway. Earnhardt drops to the inside against Ricky Rudd, pulling up on Mark Martin.
Johnny Benson going with Earnhardt down on the bottom side, and just behind him, 20-car Tony Stewart.
Side by side for fourth behind Jeff Burton, Rusty Wallace, and Mark Martin. We'll be right back.
Race Summer is sponsored by Haviland. Add more life to your car.
At 126 laps, 34 laps to go, 85 miles, 8 leaders, 10 lead changes, 144 mile an hour average, 4 cautions, and the attrition continues to develop. There you see some of the latest victims in the event. We still have 33 cars all tucked together out here in the lead lap, and let's get back with the action and Mike Joy.
Hard to believe, Ken, that two cars from the same team got racing side by side and allowed the front six to get away. But Dale Earnhardt and Mike Skinner got in a battle for seventh place, and that allowed a six-car breakaway.
It did. But now Earnhardt has gotten around Skinner, and DJ has pulled up there right behind him, so they're going to try to hook up and run them back down.
And for you people that are joined us and don't know Ned Jarrett, he's talking about Dale Jarrett, DJ, who is on the move right now. He sat on the pole here, but has not been able to get back up to the lead once he lost it.
From our Ford onboard camera, from Dale Jarrett's car.
Brake shocks, batteries, tires, and more. Boy, you got to have it all here tonight.
Especially more.
Yes.
Jeff Burton is your race leader.
Whoa,
there's Johnny Benson loose. That white car on the left of your screen.
What a great job.
Never backed off, just stayed right in the throttle.
Can't afford to back off. Look at Earnhardt weaving around. That's Earnhardt Jr., the number 8 car.
And as Bill Elliott found out, if you lift, not only do you lose, but you have a good chance to go to the wall. That's how close they're running. If you lift off the throttle, somebody will slam you.
Well, it wasn't, but just a second ago, Dale Jarrett was back in this group back here, 3 wide. Now he and Earnhardt are running down the leaders.
As Benson pulls that second pack around, Earnhardt Jr. to the outside, Gordon to the inside. Jeff Gordon's 24, up for 10th place. Benson squirrely in the middle, shuffled back. Remember, did he only take two tires at last pit stop?
He did. Of course, Jeff Burton, who's leading this race, only took two tires also at that last pit stop. But he hadn't gotten shuffled out yet.
On the point, Jeff Burton, his crew chief, Frankie Stoddard, as an 11-year-old, turned wrenches for Butch Elms at the local speedways, then went to work for Busch North Series legend Stubb Fadden, and then came south. He worked his way into the crew chief position for Jeff Burton at Roush Racing. He's got Rusty Wallace, who has scratched and clawed his way from a first caution flag penalty up to second place. Then Tony the Tiger, Tony Stewart, and that Pontiac.
Boy, what a drive he's had tonight. He was back in that group not long ago, 3 wide also, but he is one of the best drafters with the least amount of experience of anybody out there right now, but everything he does is perfect out there tonight.
He's driven a great race, no doubt about that. Now Earnhardt and Jarrett have caught that crowd as we watch this racing back in the pack.
Robert Presley on the 77, the wrenchhead.com telemetry, as he battles Matt Kenseth in a backup car after a practice crash. And Wally Donnelback touching with Kenseth.
Kenseth got into Wally Dahlenbach's left rear corner there. I tell you what, that was almost a real wreck for us.
And it still could be. The way they're running here. Still three wide. That Kenseth, the yellow car in the middle. He's a rookie. Well, he's getting a good hard lesson here.
Now that's back in the third pack net. Seven, eight cars have broken away. Then about 12 cars single file, and then this battle.
Thought Kenseth had an opening there in front of Kenny Wallace, but he couldn't get up there quick enough. He wants out of that position. Yep. I don't blame him. Now he finds a hole down on the bottom of the racetrack.
None of the top six drivers have ever won a Winston Cup race at Daytona. Jeff Burton, Rusty Wallace, Tony Stewart, Mark Martin, Ricky Rudd, Ward Burton will make that top five as Dale Earnhardt, Daytona's winningest driver, moves up to sixth place. 134 laps complete. Just 26 to go. It's still anybody's race. And we'll be back after this message and a word from your local station. The Army ruled a captain's death suicide and not murder. It might make sense to them, but it didn't to 60 Minutes. That story Sunday. The Dale and Dale Express have closed on the leaders, and they are coming, Earnhardt and Jarrett.
They passed Ricky Rudd. They passed Mark Martin. Now they go after Tony Stewart.
Tony, he won't be able to fight him off there. They're going to team up on him. And Mark Martin, the third car there, a three-car draft, and Tony Stewart hung out to dry on the outside, fighting back on the outside. But you see Earnhardt in third spot already.
Buddy, just as you said at the top of the show, who do you want to go with? The fastest car. And the two Dales, Earnhardt and Jarrett, have hooked up.
Well, here comes Stewart back up on the outside of DJ. Tony Stewart has a fast race car. And he gets in the right position, but he's in the wrong position there right now because he just lost third and fighting for fifth.
Behind Burton and Wallace. Now it's Earnhardt and Jarrett, then this side-by-side battle.
And boy, they'll lose back in a hurry if they stay side-by-side back there. There's Rusty Wallace, one of his crew members, looking on. Now remember, the two Dales took on four tires during their last stop. The two guys in front of them only took two. That was.
And what they've been doing is just picking off a car lap. And this lap, they kind of stayed, but they run the front bunch down from about four car lengths back. Now they're nose to tail as they head into turn one.
As they get nearer the front, they get tougher to pass. But they've worked together good so far. They've come from pretty far back in the pack.
20 laps to go this time by. Folks, about 17 minutes, and we'll have a winner in one of the most closely contested 400s in Daytona history. Anybody in this lead pack could still win this race.
Now, Mark Martin has, once he got around Tony Stewart, has pulled back up to them.
Ralph Shaheen.
Mike, leader Jeff Burton is good friends with Duke University basketball coach Mike Krzyzewski, and Coach Krzyzewski has given Jeff a lot of tips about how to get mentally focused when it comes to battle. But Jeff said he got his best coaching tip from his four-year-old daughter, Paige, who just said to him one day, "Daddy, did you do your best?"
Mike Krzyzewski's troops never came down the floor at 190 miles an hour.
And Dale Earnhardt looking to the inside of Rusty Wallace. So almost contact there as they go down the back straightaway. Rusty's out of position now.
If Burton comes down to the bottom, and he does, Wallace goes backwards.
And Earnhardt moves into second. Well, look at Wallace go backwards. He's up there by himself, nobody to draft with. Goes all the way back to sixth position.
Tony Stewart gets by.
From Ricky Rudd in seventh place. Looking ahead now at where Rusty Wallace has gotten back into line in sixth. That's how quickly you can go from the front of the pack right to the back.
The big, running second a lap ago.
The big dogs are beginning to bark, I tell you. Earnhardt in second right now, and he's picking them off, getting them coming out of the corner. Seems to put that bumper just under the left rear corner and get some pushing up out of the corner. And with Dale Jarrett pushing him, hey, they have a rocket ship, both of them, so they're moving in.
Earnhardt is the master at loosening someone up. Jeff Gordon is a master at it as well, but he's not in this hunt.
21 cars are in this lead draft. 33 are on the lead lap. as Gordon runs in 11th. Earnhardt Jr. on the bottom of the racetrack there at 13th. And back up front. They're straining on that leash, those big dogs.
Yeah, he's sizing him up. Where are we going to do this? Mark Martin getting a little antsy back there on DJ's back bumper.
This is the best run Mark Martin's had at Daytona in a long time. Kim Burton, her husband's in the lead.
You think they don't have it tough, too?
They also serve who stand and wait.
Right now, I'm watching Jeff Burton, and he's able to hold that car right on that yellow line. It'd be tough to get under him to make him push getting up off the corner.
Well, he's got to get up to him before he can do that. You're right, but he's got to get real close to him to make the car push up. Now Earnhardt's got to run on him going into turn one. He'll get pretty close going in there. Let's see how it works.
Earnhardt's in a tough spot. If he makes his move to the outside of the board, all those Fords file in underneath. If Jeff Burton doesn't give him any room on the bottom, where does Earnhardt have to go to try to make the pass?
Mike, I think we're no longer worried about Fords and Chevrolets right now. It's the guys that they can work the best with, and I know that Earnhardt right now sizing him up. In just a little while, you'll probably see him try that outside move just to see whether they gain any at all.
The man in black, Dale Earnhardt, in second place. Behind Virginia's Jeff Burton, 17 laps to go. Island next, an all-new Survivor Wednesday at 8, 7 Central on CBS. Who will be voted out of the lead next? 13 laps to go this time by.
Well, I tell you, Mike, they had to put my mom in the hospital this morning with a heart problem. Might have to put her son in the hospital with a heart problem here if this keeps up.
Jeff Burton continues to lead. Dale Jarrett fought his way up to second. Two laps ago, Earnhardt went to the bottom. Burton came down to block, left the high groove open for Jarrett, and he tried to take Rusty Wallace with him. And Earnhardt is third, Wallace is fourth. Mark Martin, Tony Stewart, Ricky Rudd.
And the car really on the move right now. It's in fourth place. Rusty Wallace really made some great moves in the corner there to get himself where he's at right now.
Yeah, he moved back to sixth when he got shuffled out there a moment ago and has picked up two of those positions back to fourth. He has a fast race car.
Dale Jarrett trying to tie Cale Yarborough's mark of three consecutive Daytona Winston Cup victories. Right now, Jeff Burton is the man in the way. As Burton tries to pick up his second win of the season, he won at Las Vegas.
I'm trying to find some flaw in the way that Jeff Burton's car is handling and where they could maybe make a move on him. But right at the moment, he's running in perfect line around the racetrack.
He really is. That car, even though he just took the right side tires during that pit stop, is hanging right down on the bottom of the racetrack, and it'll be tough to pass him.
None of the front four have teammates in close proximity. Burton's teammate, Mark Martin, is back there in fifth place. Burton was second in the Daytona 500, don't forget, to the man right now in his mirror, Dale Jarrett. Dick Berggren.
Well, Frank Stoddard's crew chief for that car that's in the lead. You guys strong enough to hold all those big dogs back?
I don't know. The XI cars are pretty good. Guys have been great off pit road tonight. Got us a good pit stop there. Jeff's done an exceptional job. You know, we don't come and come to win these restricted plate races, but we haven't always put ourselves in the greatest position. He's done a super job so far tonight. And, you know, I'm not sure whether the two tires are going to be able to hold those guys off or not, but if it does, you know, it'll be a good race.
Well, they're in position now to Bill.
Todd Parrott, crew chief for Dale Jarrett. Doesn't look like there's much strategy here. He's just going to empty his bucket, I guess.
Yeah, you know, the guy that's out there in second right now, he's probably one of the sharpest out there, but he's got a guy behind him that's pretty smart, too. You know, just lucky to get back up front with but had a trouble on the pit stop. The guys have done great. And this driver out here, he loves Daytona. He's putting on a show. I guess it's the first show we've really had all night long, but him and Earnhardt, maybe we can get a push from Dale, and maybe we can make it three in a row. But just want to come out of here with a good finish.
It's that chess game you were talking about, Mike. To Ralph Shaheen.
Kevin, your driver's back to third now. Can you mount another charge with the help of Rusty Wallace?
Possibly. Rusty's got a pretty strong car, but I think Dale Jarrett's kind of just sitting there waiting to make the move. He you know, he pushed us back up there pretty good, and I think he can pretty much pull out and pass whenever he feels like it.
So are you more interested in following Dale Jarrett than looking for a push from Rusty?
We're more interested in getting to the front, however that happens to be.
That's right. Hey, I liked his confidence there in DJ. I'm not quite that confident myself.
Nine laps to go. However this turns out, it'll be good for Jarrett and Earnhardt because point leader in the Winston Cup Championship chase, Bobby Labonte, is back in 18th position. So both Jarrett and Earnhardt stand to gain.
Right now, you're looking at Jeff Burton going down through there, leading this race. His wife not quite as happy as he is right now because she knows that he has to run the perfect line on every lap. One little mistake, and he could be as far back as fifth or sixth.
And the lead draft, six cars have a little advantage on Ricky Rudd, but those seven right behind, led by Rudd, are still in this show with eight laps to go this time. Will Dale Jarrett wait to pull the trigger?
Well, if he has anything that Frankie Stoddard thinks that he might have, he might wait till the last lap. But I don't know if he can afford to wait that long.
Just behind the leader's net, Ricky Rudd way up high in turn number two. And look at the gap that opened up.
Boy, Ricky opened it up in a hurry. Ward Burton right behind Ricky Rudd. Jeff Gordon right behind Ward Burton.
Well, they know they've done their job. Now it's up to the driver to do the right thing. And I'll tell you right now, somebody's got to make a mistake for anybody to pass anyone.
One of those six cars coulda, shoulda, woulda,
wanna
win it. Oh, they all wanna.
Yeah, they all
wanna. We got it.
Jeff Burton, Dale Jarrett, Dale Earnhardt, Rusty Wallace, Mark Martin, Tony Stewart. From the engine to the caboose of those six cars, it's only 7/10 of a second. Then Ricky Rudd, leading Ward Burton, Jeff Gordon, Chad Little. Good run tonight. Tony, Mike Skinner.
Tony Stewart looking for that high line to see if he can get by Mark Martin just behind this group. I'm watching everybody. I'm telling you what. They're running a perfect line around the racetrack, and how do you pass somebody when they're running that perfect line?
Yep. Trouble back straight away. Car sliding down to the infield. There's Spencer in big trouble. This run to the caution. If they can't get it cleaned up, this could be the race. Here they come. Off turn number four, trying for a second win of the year. Jeff Burton leads them to the caution flag with Jarrett, Earnhardt, Wallace, and Martin. Jimmy Spencer.
All four tires flat on that car, so he spun many times round and round.
The inner liners are holding it up. Enough to get him back to the pits.
Not sure if anyone else was involved there coming off turn number two. Spencer trying to salvage a finish here for Travis Carter. And if he is the only car involved and there is no debris, we should be able to get back to green to finish this off.
I would think so. I think we'd have three or four laps maybe.
Well, I can tell you one thing about this type of race. When you go back with just a couple of laps to run, that restart is so very, very important.
Fireworks from Jimmy Spencer's car. Yeah, the tires go down.
Yeah, that tire finally just the wheel locked up on the right front.
You know who's got to be smiling tonight is Mark Martin. He's only had one top five finish in his last eight Daytona races. That was fifth this February. So he'll have a good night tonight. They're going to try to get Spencer back out.
They get that wheel off. Well, that thing is welded on there.
It's probably wrapped around the top A-frame there and all, so they're having a time with it.
You know, you hear about the drivers and the spotters and everybody making deals. There's going to be some deal making now. We asked some of the drivers, can you rely on your friends on the track?
Look, I've been all through that, and trust me, I don't care what anybody else tells you, anybody else you interview, there is no deals. It might last for two or three laps. But just about the time that guy gets hung out to dry, he's trying to make a deal with somebody else. Everybody's trying to make a deal with somebody, and there is no deal out there. In restrictor plate racing, it's each guy for himself.
In today's time, I think there's less cooperating going on, particularly in the latter part of the races, but obviously there's some guys that I know when they tell me they'll follow me, they'll follow me. Then the other guys that I know they'll use me and dump me as soon as they get the opportunity.
You have to have partners. So the question is, how long does that partner stay your buddy? And that's the big question mark on everybody's mind. But you'll use them, and they'll use you as long as they can until it's not comfortable anymore. It's not helping them.
Well, I can answer your question there. You want a friend? Bring a dog with you.
Kenny Irwin, Matt Kenseth make pit stops along with Kenny Schrader, Kevin LePage, Ricky Craven, and Darrell Walter. Ralph?
Todd Parrott is the crew chief for Dale Jarrett. Todd, you got one last shot at him starting from this yellow. Is your car strong enough to do it all on its own, or do you need help from Dale Earnhardt behind you?
Well, I'm sure he's going to have a real good push from that guy behind him. Looks real similar to what happened in February. Just have to see what happens. We've got a great race car, great smart race car driver, and he does a lot of good things here in Daytona. Daytona's been good to us, so we'll see what happens.
Have you guys made any deals with the three car?
He hasn't said a word, and I haven't said a word to him. He knows what he's got to do.
Sometimes, Mike, those deals can be made just between the drivers, though, with hand signals. They'll be waving back and forth which way they want to go if they're going to hook up together.
Four laps to decide this. Talk about a Saturday night shootout.
You hear all these deals and all, but I'm going to tell you, if you get a great start and you can pass somebody, you're going by him.
Yeah.
It don't matter what you say beforehand, you're going to pass that person.
And everybody's still here and they're standing.
They're going to race 10 miles when they come back and get the green flag. Jeff Burton, the leader, Dale Jarrett, both in Fords, Dale Earnhardt Chevrolet, Rusty Wallace's Ford, Mark Martin in a Ford, the Pontiac of Tony Stewart, Ricky Rudd, Ward Burton, Jeff Gordon, Chad Little, the top 10. Anybody can still win this. Okay. Ralph?
Mike, apparently the two of Rusty Wallace and the six of Mark Martin are chatting back and forth on the radio. Those two Fords are looking to hook up. Right now they're lined up in fourth and fifth. They're going to try to run together to get through to the front.
A lot of those deals now are not made on pit road. They're made amongst the spotters up on the roof talking with each other. And there's Robert Yates, who owns the pole sitting second place car of Dale Jarrett and the seventh place car of Ricky Rudd.
Pace car coming off the racetrack. The green flag will fly.
Four laps to go. Folks, can you sit still for 3 minutes?
If you only pass on the outside to get the start finish line, and Jeff Burton is protecting that. Now he comes, Jarrett tries it on the inside, then he tries it on the outside, and Burton blocking him every move he makes.
Still gaining speed. Won't be till they come around to the start finish line. They'll be back to 190 miles an hour. Moves in mid-pack at 10th place. Chad Little battling side by side.
Now Jarrett's back about two car lengths as they head down towards the back straightaway there, down the back straightaway. He does have a run there, but you see what happened there. Jeff Burton pulls to the inside when he sees Jarrett coming, but look behind him.
Three wide. Rusty Wallace to the inside, sandwiching Earnhardt and sending him backwards.
Mark Martin up on the high side of Rusty Wallace there. Tony Stewart pushing the two car there of Wallace as they come off turn four.
It's a Ford front four. They shuffled the Chevys and Pontiacs out of there. Three laps to go.
Rusty's got to run on DJ now as they come down the front straightaway here. They try to go around Burton, but Burton blocks every move that they make.
Boy, that's not going to last there. I'm going to tell you, you're going to run out of racetrack looking in the mirror quite that way. You can miss your mark getting in the corner by running that mirror that much.
That's certainly riding with that rearview mirror.
Dale Earnhardt Jr. has dropped to the apron and to the back of the pack. That will put him 33rd. Jeff Burton out front has the world's widest rear bumper.
Boy, he does have. He's made good use of it, too. Here comes Rusty.
Watch that two car of Wallace as he pulls down on Dale Jarrett.
And Ricky Rudd's in that front group now. He's really made a move to the front.
Got five Fords there battling it out.
Two laps to go. Ward Burton and Tony Stewart, the two Pontiacs, fighting back at sixth place. Side by side. Earnhardt behind them.
Yeah, Earnhardt's got nowhere to go right now. He's just sitting in the middle there waiting on these guys to determine where they're going to go.
And that's two frustrating finishes in a row for Earnhardt at Pocono, rather two out of three. where he got muscled up by Mayfield in the last lap.
Looking back from your leader, Dale Jarrett, the second place car, as they go down the back straightaway. Jarrett inches up, not runs up, inches up.
3 miles to go.
And the crew is looking at it. There's Jeff Burton's crew looking to see if he's going to be able to hold them all.
And Jeff Burton would love to see somebody try DJ on the bottom side or high side. If they get side by side, that would give him white flag.
Dale Jarrett has been the fastest car in qualifying, one of the fastest in practice. Jeff Burton had only 2 fresh tires on that last stop, but he's done everything to keep Jarrett in his mirror. 2 miles to go.
Kim Burton looking on, praying. Not breathing much right now. Come on, Jeff, she says.
Wallace trying to line up with Jarrett. Can they make a move? Will Burton give them anywhere to go?
I don't think he will.
I think Burton's going to run that perfect line. Jarrett looks to the outside now. Nowhere to go there. Trying the bottom side again.
Jeff Burton won his first Winston Cup race on CBS. He comes off turn 4, and he's going to win the last Winston Cup race on CBS. Jeff Burton over Dale Jarrett, Rusty Wallace, and Mark Martin. Pepsi 400.
He did a marvelous job of protecting his territory.
Now that was a chess game. That was a chess game, and he did block the racetrack. It is his racetrack to block. When you're leading, you can do what you please.
Absolutely. Protecting his territory.
The NapaOnline.com margin of victory, 0.149 seconds. Jeff Burton over Dale Jarrett.
Drivers come by to congratulate him.
Second win of the year. He won earlier in Las Vegas and had top 5 finishes, a second at Daytona, 5th at Darlington, 2nd at Texas and Martinsville, and 5th in California. So in a reversal of the Daytona 500 finish, Jeff Burton defeats Dale Jarrett. We'll talk to him in a minute.
CBS Sports presentation of the Pepsi 400 is sponsored by Lowe's Home Improvement Warehouse. Lowe's improving home improvement. Ford F-Series, the best-selling trucks are built Ford tough. Of Cola. Circuit City.
Career victory for Jeff Burton in Winston Cup racing, and you ride with him into hallowed ground, Daytona Victory Lane. And it's the first time in the Pepsi 400 history that one manufacturer has swept the top 5. They were all Fords.
Couldn't hang in there at the end, or got shuffled out, whatever the case might have been. But the Pontiacs that were up there all night long in the top 5 brought back.
Buddy, that's about the best job of mirror driving I've ever seen.
Well, he did a great job of protecting that lead. A lot of people say that's cutting him off, but he was in the lead and he was mirror driving. There was no question about it, but he did what he had to do. Run that perfect line through the corner, gave him no place to make that pass on him.
Earnhardt tried the bottom. He came down to block. Jarrett tried the high side. He went up to block. Jeff Burton is the man of the hour here in Daytona Beach. Great run for the Jack Roush team, for Frank Stoddard and his over-the-wall crew. And now Jeff Burton will come up to Ken Squire and accept the accolades of the Pepsi 400 victory. Ken?
A great offensive, a great defensive performance. Let's get him over here. They said in the booth, here he is kissing his wife, Kim. They said you did the perfect lap, and it certainly was. What a performance.
Well, these guys have done a great job in the restricted plate program for us. As much as we struggled on it, the engine department, the fabrication department, the engineers, everybody has gone to a lot of effort. And the restart was tough. Best in the business behind me, and I blocked him pretty bad, but that's what you got to do.
Well, you certainly blocked him beautifully, and it was a great race to the finish. John Graham is here with Jack Roush. Let's make the presentation of the award.
A new face in Victory Lane at Daytona. Jeff Burton, congratulations on your first NASCAR Winston Cup win at Daytona International Speedway, along with Brent Franks, Vice President of the Pepsi-Cola Company. It's our pleasure to present you with the Pepsi 400 trophy. You really lit it up.
I'll pick it up.
we've struggled in. Great win for us. Great win.
Well, you've always said you were pessimistic. You've said that the better you get, the more you expect of yourself. You can't expect much more than what you gave tonight.
No, I drove a good race tonight, but, you know, I drove a good race, and they did a great job repairing the car. And we got a guy at home that was just diagnosed with cancer, Rodney. We got to hurry back. Rodney's shirt's on, and this one's for him. This one's for him.
Thank you very much, Jeff Burton. Let's go back to Mike Joy.
Thanks, Ken. We'll be back with the order of finish and the Winston Cup point standings at Daytona International Speedway after this. No
problem. Yeah, we're done here. TA Sports presentation of the Pepsi 400 is sponsored by Lowe's Home Improvement Warehouse. Lowe's improving home improvement. Ford F-Series, the best-selling trucks are built Ford tough. And by Doc Otis, a new flavored alcohol malt beverage. Real lemon, real refreshment. Unlock the dock.
Welcome back to Daytona International Speedway. Fireworks everywhere, but they certainly provided enough of them on the track tonight. What a wild race.
Ned was about to beat me to death the last five laps there, and I don't blame him. What an exciting race.
It was. What a great way for CBS to go out as far as Winston Cup races are concerned. One of the best races we've seen in a long, long time.
Bobby Labonte came up there for 12th at the end to hang on to the Winston Cup point lead. Jeff Burton, the third different restrictor plate winner this year. Dale Jarrett in Daytona, Jeff Gordon at Talladega, and now Jeff Burton here. What a wild race right down to the end. Any one of six drivers could have won it. And here's a look at the rest of the final standings as the crowd has stayed here to celebrate with Jeff Burton, our Pepsi 400 winner.
32 cars on the lead lap,
including Darrell Waltrip, making his final Daytona start.
And stayed out that extra lap just so he could say, I did lead my last time at Daytona.
Labonte will leave here and head for Loudoun, New Hampshire with a 52-point advantage over Dale Earnhardt, Dale Jarrett, Ward Burton. Jeff Burton moves up. There's a look at the top dozen. That includes rookie Matt Kenseth. Boy, it's been such a pleasure and a privilege and a great ride from up here. Let's go trackside to Ken Squire for final thoughts.
Thank you very much, Michael. Just wonderful to see all these people still standing, still applauding. And after 22 seasons, CBS bids a final goodbye from Daytona. Thank you for having been a part of it with us. And thanks to everyone at the Daytona International Speedway and NASCAR, who over the years always made it a joy to come to the birthplace of speed for the Pepsi 400 and for the great American race, the Daytona 500 each February. To everyone in the Daytona future, have a good ride.